David, you won't believe it, but there is a dressage display going on just to the right-hand side of where we are now. But we must not get overexcited because we are meditating, aren't we, David? Yes, the pre-show meditation. That is what that Nyala is doing. He is also doing pre-show meditation. Very pretty. Now it is 35 degrees Celsius, 95 degrees Fahrenheit here. We are going to Cheetah Plains. On the other vehicle, Taylor McCurdy is going to Arethusa. Do you feel at peace, David?
Absolutely.
Yes. I too, you can see, I'm filled with peace. Let us drive past Mr. and Mrs. Hallberg's. Then we must also do our lip warming exercises, mustn't we, David?
Yes.
Benedict Cumberbatch. Benedict Cumberbatch. Cumberbatch. Benedict Cumberbatch sells shells on the... Benedict Cumberbatch is a shell seller on the shore of the sea. Benedict Cumberbatch is the best Sherlock Holmes ever. Benedict Cumberbatch, Cumberbatch. Red lorry, yellow lorry, red lorry, yellow lorry, red lorry, yellow lorry, red lorry, yellow lorry. Red lorry, yellow lorry, red lorry, yellow lorry, red lorry, yellow lorry, red lorry, yellow lorry. And then, David, one must wire one's brain so that it functions when one is on drive, because, you know, you're listening to Louise Pavide in the ear, you're listening to Game Drive, I'm paying attention to the signs of the wild. And so one must tap one's head and rub one's belly at the same time, which of course very few people can do. See, I'm doing both, David, at the same time. You see that? It's very good. There we are. 2 minutes, everybody, until the real show begins. And then, of course, you must practice, David, getting out of the meditation into the real energy of the show. And we shall do that now by going, ha! Ha! And that just helps us to note the two energy levels. Good. David, what are you hoping to see today?
I'd like to see a leopard.
I'd also like to see a leopard, David. Let us pass that thought on to the universe so that they may give us, or it, or she, or he may give us, a leopard. Now we are going to begin the show in 30 seconds. For those of you who are watching the pre-show to the show, I think Taylor is going to begin. Is that correct, Louise Pavide? Right, it is going to be Taylor McCurdy starting the show, everyone, and I'm going to hand you over to her and the disclaimer. See you shortly.
This program features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Welcome to a very hot and humid afternoon in the African wilderness, and this is Safari Live.
Ready.
Danny.
Goodbye.
One, you are live, you are live.
Hello again and welcome, like I said earlier, to an incredibly hot and humid afternoon. My name is Taylor and on camera with me we have Brian and the Thumb, who I don't even know who the Thumb is today. I'm going to have a look. Where is the Thumb?
You can't get it in.
You can't get it in with the bunt. Let's pause so we can get the Thumb, because we know the Thumb is very important. Oh, is that a knife?
Yes.
Knife Thumb, very sharp. Hopefully we won't get any sarcastic remarks from the Thumb this afternoon. Now, we've just arrived at Red Dam. Remember this morning I mentioned to you that the Nkuhumas had killed some buffalo around here. But now we need to try and find out where exactly they are. So we're here on Arethusa at Red Dam. Let's have a little look at the watering hole and see what's happening. Now, Brian, do you see any lions here? I don't. I just see some water that looks extremely inviting, and I wouldn't mind jumping in and having a little swim. The only thing that's really around are two blacksmith lapwings. There they are running, racing around, possibly looking for something to eat. And I suspect that they'll find lots of little insects on the surface of the water and along that sort of muddy section. And then there's also, oh no, there's an array of birds. There's a sandpiper down on the left. There's actually two little birds there. There's a little, oh no, it's gone now. There goes the sandpiper. Bye-bye. Isn't that beautiful? Bobbing away. No, now it's having a good groom. And there's one last little bird that I want to show you. It's a little three-banded plover, which is way on the left. I have to duck down for this one. There it is. Also collecting all the little insects. Now, wasn't that a wonderful way to start the safari? Having a look and seeing three different species of birds. Now, we're going to continue the search for the elusive Nkuhumas. And remember, there's still James. James is driving this afternoon. It's a bit hot. And James would like to say hello to you.
Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to this end of your sunset safari. The sun is not quite setting yet, but it is mercifully behind some cloud, and you can see that. Ah, it's actually quite pleasant now that it is behind the cloud. I'm sure the clouds, like the politicians of the world, the US certainly at the moment, and certainly in South Africa, promising much, but will they deliver? That is the question. My name is James Hendry, in case you're wondering. David is on camera. Hello, David. Very nice. David has got quite an impressive array of hair that I noticed today, which made me feel very jealous. On account of the fact that I have none. Now, we're going to be going to Cheetah Plains today, and we are completely live, as Taylor is. Hashtag Safari Live if you'd like to ask us any questions. Otherwise, you can send an email, questions@wildearth.tv. No other form of communication will work. Not mail, not carrier pigeon, not... what's that other thing that people do? You know that... Smoke signals, they also won't work. It's not the one I'm thinking of. It begins with a T. I've lost my mind. Telepathic. Telepathic. There we go. Or Morse code or telegraph. There we go. Good. So that is the plan this afternoon. It was something else of vital importance I needed to tell you. Oh, yes. That was that Karula went south apparently yesterday evening sometime. So we don't think she's here. But I've come down towards Twin Dams, which is where she went across sometime this morning. Maybe she's back. Maybe she isn't. Maybe there'll be something drinking at Twin Dams. You're most welcome on our little drive for the next 3 hours. I hope you enjoy yourself with us. Oh, Cat in Tampa, you want to know if you see a bird on the pre-show show. Is there, does it count for your list? Yes, absolutely it counts for your list, Cat. Especially if you can get me to say anything coherent during the pre-show show, then absolutely it costs. It counts. Costs. Counts. Yes, and thank you for not interrupting my meditation, Cat, with a question during the pre-show show. Now, there's some impala up ahead, so let's stop at them. That's a good start. Now, what we're looking for two things here. The first thing we're looking for is the first Impala lamb of the season, which is not here. The second thing we're looking for is mange, evidence of mange. And that's because we found it now on jackals, we found it on Nyala, we found it on, I think, Dika. We've definitely found it on the lions, obviously. So it's clearly something of an epidemic that's going through everyone here. That male looks ropey in the extreme. And I think that's very strange. This drought has brought about all sorts of diseases that these animals are not used to fighting off. I'd really do like the colour for me is an important part of everyday living, and while I make no claim to be a colourist of any sort, it's always these little combinations of colour that I really enjoy, and the green of the bushes and that red colour of the impala's fur I really like a lot. In the background, some crickets, and of course the black-headed oriole as well. Right, Taylor is still at Red Dam looking for the lions. I'm not sure if she's managed to find them. Let's find out.
Well, we are trying our best. Now, Brian and I, and of course Thumb, we're trying to follow our noses because I can't get hold of any of the Arethusa Rangers. So we're just going to follow all the vehicle tracks that are around here until it takes us to the lions. And there's definitely something that has died here because it smells a bit, well, it's a bit smelly. But let's have a look. I'm just going to scan around here. I don't want to miss them. They said they were at the dam, but I didn't see anything at the dam, so I wonder if it wasn't, they aren't around here somewhere. Where are you, Leons? Don't hide from me for day number two. I don't see anything here. Let's go back. There's some more tracks here. Let's follow these ones. Oh, there's very, very many different sets of vehicle tracks going up and down and around. Now, perhaps if you've just tuned in for the first time and you're wondering what on earth we are doing, we are on a live safari. And if you'd like to chat to us and ask us any questions, oh, be careful here, Brian. You're welcome to do so by either hashtagging Safari Live, or you can pop us an email at questions@wildearth.tv. Right, let's see. Oh, I've just lost my earpiece out of my ear. Nkahumas. I hope James finds something interesting at Cheetah Plains. I haven't actually been to Cheetah Plains in ages. I'll definitely have to take a swing past there at some point. Right, I can't see anything up here. I don't know, I must be going crazy. We'll just take a little bit of a drive a little bit further along. Don't know why I didn't see anything around here. Sorry, sandpiper. Just chase the sandpiper away again. Just as it was starting to settle in. I'm going to go back sort of the way I came. I just want to double and triple check, and I'm also trying to listen to the radio, but it's very difficult. Oh, I see. This is where the difficult part is. We've got to try and figure out what's going on around here. Brian, do you have any suggestions?
No,
I don't think that they're here because that smell was coming from back the other way. Okay, well, we'll go back. Eventually, if we go up and down here enough, we're probably going to bump into them. Let's see. The guides are chatting again. Well, maybe they'll share us some valuable information that I'll hear sort of a couple of words and then be able to put two and two together. Now, normally, if they're at the dam, they should have been quite obvious to see. But I'm clearly missing something. What do you think, Brian? Do you think I'm missing some information? We
can smell something. Let's go around the corner. Let's go down here and check in the drainage. Maybe there was a kill around here and then they've taken it and dragged it down to the drainage. But we also know what the Nkuhumas are like, and that because they're so spoilt at the moment, they don't seem to be finishing their carcasses off. That one that they took down yesterday, they left it. We've got some zebra. So now I'm very confused as to where the lions are. I also saw a couple of impala hanging around here. So maybe they've completely moved off. Just check for footprints as we drive. Right. Let's have a quick look at these. The zebra that's over here. Let's see what's happening. Hi, zebra. Have you seen any lions this afternoon? No? I'd take that as a big no. Looks like we've got a stallion. There was another one as well. Possibly it also looks like a stallion in the far distance. And they're quite happily munching away, carrying on with their days. Now, zebra, be careful, because I've heard rumors that there's lions around here. And I don't know if you've met the Nkuhumas before, but I would be very, very cautious around them. But we don't often see the lions catching zebra. They do enjoy eating zebra. We actually saw the zebras being caught in Kenya, in the Mara with James, which is quite interesting. And it's amazing how the different lions in the different areas prefer different species. It was like when I was down in the Eastern Cape, they absolutely love wildebeest, as well as an antelope called a blesbuck. They used to catch them all the time. We didn't really see them eating buffalo, and occasionally they would also catch giraffe, which was quite amazing to see. Right, but I think what we're going to do now is we're going to carry on searching, and I'm going to try and drive to a little high point and see if I can't get hold of somebody from Arethusa. And while I do that, before we lose James, let's go across to him.
That, everybody, is my Hardy Die impression, and it's very good, isn't it, David? Yes, it is. Apparently, I was asked to do that by Taylor. She said I had to do a Hardy Die impression, so that's what I've done. Of course, the master of the Hardy Die impression, and indeed probably all impressions, is Brian Joubert. Just listen in the background there. Sounds like a human being, doesn't it? That is the orange-breasted bush shrike, not the hadeda, which is mercifully silent. As I've said to you before, after a big night out, the last thing you want to do is be assailed by the call of a hadeda on your roof at 5 a.m. Now, there are some squirrels alarm calling up ahead as well, so we're just going to keep an eye on the road to see if the queen doesn't pop out. In the meantime, I will show you a picture, to those of you who haven't seen it, of the orange-breasted bush shrike. Now, I've only found the orange-breasted bushrike in this book about 7,874 times, and yet still I must go to the index to look up bushrike. Shh, there we go. 401. There it is. That is the orange-breasted bushrike over there. Isn't he gorgeous? So gorgeous. Right, that is the, in fact, in speaking of gorgeous, that is the gorgeous bushrike there. There we are, beautiful. Now, a comment from somebody who of whom we are all very fond indeed, and that is Nicola Austin. Hello, Nicola Austin, all the way from Kenya. She is speaking to us, everyone. She's sending her fond regards to Louise and Kirsten. Of course, Taylor and I are chop liver to Nicola, apparently. So is David, so is Brian. Oh well, We still love you, Nicola, and thank you for tuning in to this marvellous safari here from, as you well know, the northeast corner of South Africa. This is very good news. Nikki says she misses you. Now, who you is, I don't know. She doesn't say. So I'm just going to take it that she misses us all. This is where the squirrel was alarm calling. So that's why I've stopped here. And apparently, everybody, Scott has managed to get out of the office today and is actually guiding today. So I'm sure he's much happier doing that than sending emails. They also, in case you haven't been following the fates of Scott and Nikki, they have some chickens, a vegetable patch, and various other interesting things going on in Kenya. Follow them on Instagram. You will not be vaguely disappointed. All right, on we go. The squirrel has stopped alarm calling. It may well have been at David's impressive long locks that it was alarming, because he looks a little bit like a lion, but I'm not sure. Whatever it was is not here. It is also, of course, Scott Dyson's birthday tomorrow. He will be 19 tomorrow. He won't really be 19, everyone. And Nikki is very kindly sent through one more greeting to me. She says, "Hello, Chopped Liver James." Now, if you don't know who Nikki Austin and Scott Dyson are, they were two of Safari Live's favourite sons. I nearly said, well, one son and one daughter. And Scott was a presenter, and Nikki was a director. And they were here for some time. And they're now in Kenya, having an adventure. Now, here are some nyalas. A young group of nyala bulls. And I must just tell you that the amount of general game at the moment is astounding, even if it does want to hide behind a bush. I'm just going to go a little bit forward so we can get a better view of it. And the reason that there is so much general game, of course, is that there has been a relatively large amount of rain here in the northern Sabi sand. But in the south, almost nothing. So just about everything that lives down in the south has come up here. Now, that might sound like it's some sort of migration. It's really not very far down to the south of the Sabi Sand. So there is a kind of mini-migration, I suppose you could call it. There's a strange wind blowing in from the northwest. That normally brings with it a storm, so maybe we'll be lucky. There was no wind, at least there was no rain forecast for the day. And Google, which of course holds the truth to everything, doesn't it, David, says 0% chance of precipitation. Well, Google, maybe you'll be wrong today. Those lovely legs. I think I'm going to describe my legs as nyala legs from now on, David, not lapwing legs. Right, let's continue. I'm going to just reverse, everyone, so that we can get out of here and go down towards Cheetah Plains. I see behind us Andrew from Cheetah Plains has stopped. He thinks we've seen something spectacular. We could, of course, pretend that we've just left Karula going in there. Shall we do that? I don't think that would be very kind of us, David, would it? Right. They're looking at some zebra. And the zebra in the clearing there. I'd love to know how zebra became zebra. So it is though, David. What do you say?
Zebra.
Zebra, yes, that's good. Little kinship group of just three. Or it could be, it probably is actually three young stallions who will be trying to find a harem of their own. Not quite as pretty as the red juxtaposed with the green, I don't think. I like zebras more in winter, I think, where there's a golden colour to the bush. Good afternoon. Hello, everybody. Right, Taylor is having some trouble finding those lions. I suspect they've moved off and killed something else somewhere close by, but let's go and find out what the story is there.
You're quite right, James. That's definitely possible, but the problem is that I can't even find the carcasses. I don't see any signs of vulture. I have no idea. Is there perhaps another red dam that I'm not sure of? Because Brian and I can't see anything. We can get... Well, there's a smell, but the smell disappears from us. And like I said, we followed all the vehicle tracks and they just sort of do loops around each other. So we're just going to actually have to wait patiently until somebody gets here and can guide us to the sighting. But for the moment of the sighting actually being right at Red Dam, I don't think it is. I think it's in the bushes 750 kilometers from Red Dam, maybe. But I can't see anything right here. And you know how easy it is to spot those lines. It's quite dry. It's not too thick, especially around here. It's not thick at all. There's one thing that could maybe be a lion. Let me go back and just have a look. But I don't think it is. Let's see if we can go along this little track here on this side of the dam. Let's have a little squiz around here. We'll follow it again. We've done almost all of them now. We'll just triple and quadruple check until we find something. And you're just going to have to stick with me and go on this little mission. And I have yet to be able to get hold of anybody from Arethusa. Right, let's have a look here. And we're coming up to a little thicket, so maybe they're in here somewhere. There was a little stick that got stuck there that made it sound a lot worse than what it actually was. Bouncing underneath the tires. Yeah, kitty cats. Now it's fairly open. Like I said, it's not thick and you can see for a good 50, 60 meters into this thicket. And I'm not seeing anything. Come out, wherever you are. Now, as a guide, I must tell you that this is probably one of the hardest things, trying to relocate sightings of animals where you're not 100% sure where they are. You just sort of hear a couple of words and then you've got to try and guess. And then you follow the fresh tracks. But I haven't really seen any lion tracks either. Ooh. None coming out. But we shall persevere. Let's go back. Maybe we'll just have to sit at the dam and wait. It's a pity our friend the hippo is not here. At least he would have been able to have kept us company. And there should be definitely be remains of a carcass, a skull at least, if not some vertebrae and some other things. Just triple checking that maybe I'm overlooking something. This is very peculiar. Now what do you think? Can anybody help me? Perhaps. Maybe one of the viewers, maybe somebody has got some powers that they have a sort of telepathic connection within kahunas. See, we can even smell the dead smell in here. I'm going to park on top and we can look back down. I'm so sorry for the third time, Mr. Sandpiper. doesn't enjoy me very much. But we'll just wait until somebody comes around here. Because we've gone and checked the various areas. We just triple check that I didn't miss any footprints. It doesn't seem that way. But we'll have a little look at, of course, Mr. and Mrs. Blacksmith Lapwing. And they seem to be quite happy because really they've got this entire watering hole all to themselves. And aren't they quite lucky? And I love the way that they sort of sit down like that. Now you can see it's gone from being a relatively tall bird to quite small now. Now, I'm sure you can see the surface of the water, and it's rippling quite a bit. There are lots and lots of insects around on this hot, humid day. And James was actually asking if there are any signs of catfish. I haven't seen anything just yet, but I'm sure we should start to see them popping up in the dam. They're sort of quite prominent. And if you've ever wondered how do fish get transported to the various dams, because we don't introduce them. So from the tilapia and the catfish. What am I hearing? Sorry, I can hear there's a beetle or something somewhere in one of these little nooks and crannies that are in jigger, and it's crawling around. I'll try and rescue it at some point. Now, what happens is something even like this blacksmith lapwing, the Egyptian geese that we see around here, or even any of the herons or the storks, the saddle-billed storks, they often visit various water points. And if the fish have laid eggs and those birds are perhaps wading through the water, those eggs will actually get stuck to the various water birds' legs. And then when they move off and go to another water point, they actually transfer those eggs that way. And that is often how the fish are spread from dam to dam, which I think is quite amazing. But there'll definitely be some catfish in here. Maybe they're quite small. A couple of tilapia, I'm sure. Oh, I'm just listening very quickly to the radio. He might be able to get hold of somebody now. Let's see if I can get hold of anybody. Can any mobile copy me? Can anybody give me the exact lock of the Nkuhumas from Red Dam? Standing by, Ryan. A negative. I followed the two track that sort of went north of the dam, and I had a little scratch around, but I can't see anything. Whereabouts exactly were they left?
Head on to parallel, head north towards where those mud wallows were. You'll see the Nyari bumpers that were right around there.
Copy, thank you very much. So we're just having
a
look here.
I'm going more into the area, so I think you'll get a hand in the next
day. Ah, okay. So it seems as though they're not at Red Dam. Here we go.
The Red Nyama into the west of southwest where we're there this morning.
Copy, well done. Can I come and join you, please? I'm just here at Red Dam.
Oh, yeah, just stick to Ryan and Jimmy. Just stick to Ryan and Jimmy.
Copy, thank you. Okay, so I'm going to use my GPS here. So it seems as though they weren't at Red Dam at all. So we weren't going bonkers. The heat hadn't quite gotten to us and melted our brains. They're on parallel road. So, yeah. So we will go around. Let's quickly go and have a look. Like I said, I thought that was possibly the case, that they actually weren't anywhere near the dam, because we're normally quite good, hey Brian, at finding the lions. They're not always too hard to find. This morning they gave us a slip for quite some time, but that's okay. We'll get them now. So, just going to very quickly make my way there, but stick with me. It'll be well worth it. I'm not very good at navigating on Arethusa. I don't come here too often, but we'll jump onto parallel road. And I suspect in the next few meters, yes. There we go. Here's the road we need to be on. And down we go. We're not far now. And then it sounds as though somebody else has actually just got here. And the signal's sort of very intermittent around here, so you've got to try and get to the highest point to try and find anybody, but woohoo! We're on the right route. It can't be too easy all the time, otherwise I suppose it would take the fun out of it, wouldn't it? Now I can start to see vultures circling in the sky. I wonder if they've perhaps had a look. They're quite far up. I don't know if we'll try and get one of these. One that I can see. The others are quite high. It may be a little bit difficult to see, but they're up there. You'll just have to take my word for it. Well, and now we're looking for a vehicle. All the lions. Here's the mud wallow. He said something about mud wallow, so they must be close. Jared, you spot on. There's some serious pressure this afternoon. You said I need to save the cat, Reek, and you're quite right. But don't worry, we will, because another ranger has just got here and said that the lions are indeed here. So now we just need to find him. But we're on the right road. We're not anywhere near Red Dam anymore. We will get them. I'm just going to take it easy. Ah, I see a vehicle. Yeah. I hope you're as excited as I am. I haven't seen the lions now for a couple of days. Well, not actually a couple of days, just a full day, which is unusual, as you know. We normally see cats all the time. And like I said this morning, it felt as though I was off forever. It was quite strange. But here we go. I just wanted to call myself that we have got their visual and we're in their sighting. Thank you. I've got your visual. I'm in your lock. And now, unfortunately, we won't be able to stay too long. Now I can see many vultures. Many, many, many vultures. Oh, we find a little way in here. We just take it easy and go say hi, vultures. Bye, vultures. We're not going to spend too much time looking at the beautiful vultures just because, like I said, our time here is going to be very limited. Just because there's a lot of vehicles that want to come here. Remember how spoilt we have been to keep seeing the Nkuhumas? These guys don't often get to see big male lions. Not if, I'm sure if the Birmingham is are here, but nonetheless, this is probably one of the larger prides that they get to see, so it's very exciting for them. So we won't hog it. Let's creep on forward. We'll go at a snail's pace. Oh, I can start to see them. Okay, we'll just stop quickly and let this gentleman reposition. I can see the little cubs. They're in the distance. Now, the reason why I stopped and I haven't carried on moving is, and I've said this a couple of times, but I know we're constantly having new viewers. I did an exercise where we all laid down on the ground and we had 7 vehicles moving around us at once. It was horrible. I couldn't hear anything. I couldn't do it. It was a nightmare. I could imagine that the lions would get up and run away. So we try and always limit the movement. And well, it means we just have to be a little bit on the patient side. Here we go. Let's see if we can get a better view now. I wonder if we can be sneaky. What do you think? Do you think we could get under there? No, because I think that's going to be our best view. Because I think we're not going to see much at all. We're going to have to try, because I think it's going to be really worth it, because there's a beautiful gap. But we're going to have to do some ducking and diving. And we're gonna stay here. The lions are right here, but we just need to sneak under. Like I said, our time here. Okay. Like I said, I always want to get the best view for you. We're going to get a nice view here. Luckily, we've got a very small vehicle, and we're able to do things that no one else is able to do. There you go. How's that, Brian? Can you see them? There we go. We'll just step like this, because here's a little gap. Now, they've taken this kill, obviously, and taken under a couple of trees. So it's not as beautiful and as clear as what we normally see, but I suppose it's better than nothing. And finally, we've got the Nkuhumas. Now, it looks like a young buffalo that they're feeding on at the moment. Apparently, there was another, if I'm not mistaken, there were two, so I'm not sure where the other one is. I can't see too many members of the pride at the moment. I can just see this lioness and one cub. But I suspect that the others are probably just off in the shade somewhere. Hello. fellow Nikki, who's watching us from Kenya. I've heard lots about you, and it's so great that you're still watching us. Now, Nikki would like to know this afternoon, how many cubs do the Nkuhumas have? Well, Nikki, I'm so happy to say that they've had 8 cubs, and they've still got 8 cubs. How exciting is that? Because I just heard some terrible news from down south. You know how I often talk about the Southern Pride, which is very similar to the Nkuhumas, in the sense that they're made up of 5 lionesses, and they also had 8 cubs. But it sounds like 2 of the youngest cubs, unfortunately, have not made it. They haven't been seen for about 2 weeks now, which is very sad. And that's how it goes. They normally say about 60% of cubs don't even make it to adulthood. And when I say adulthood, I mean over the age of about 2. So we are very, very lucky that these little Nkuhumas are doing so well. And I think that that's thanks to the fact that we are experiencing a little drought at the moment. So the animals are weakened, and therefore the adults are being so successful in capturing their prey. And well, when there's a lot of food around, it means that adults can eat a bit, and then they're just going to be producing lots and lots of milk. And milk is so important to these cubs. It's got all the valuable nutrients that they need, and all the antibiotics and all those types of things. So that's good. Now, I don't know if we're going to be able to navigate and have a look at the others. It seems very, very thick in here. Lots of quarries and terminalias and bush willows, but sort of quite densely packed together. At least we've got a view of one. And it seems as though Arethusa is also having a fly plague at the moment. They don't discriminate, eh? The flies, they just go wherever they like. But I'm hoping that the Nkuhumas come home tonight. I'd love it if they came back north and came back on Jijuma. There's a little cub. Looks like one of the older cubs disappearing into the distance, possibly heading towards where the rest of the pride is sleeping. You can see how thick it is. How it just sort of, that cub just disappears behind all that vegetation. Remember to take lots and lots of screenshots. And we'd love to see them. And she's crunching away. She doesn't look particularly fat, does she, Brian? She hasn't got a big belly on her. But when you've got so much food around, you don't need to dive in and guts as much as you can in one go. You'll see, when we start to get into summer, when we get to sort of February, March, around that time of the year, I'm wondering if the Nkuhumas are going to continue with their success rate of capturing their prey. I think it's going to get a lot harder. And then we should see feeding frenzies around the carcass where everybody will be fighting for a bite because, well, when the bush gets greener, it becomes a lot more difficult. The animals tend to spread out. And there's not going to be so many weakened animals around, which make for easy targets. You can see she's using out the carnassial shear, trying to scissor off the flesh from the skin. Now we're seeing a lot of flies obviously on the carcasses, and I know that Gene Monster is wondering if the lions can catch anything from them. So Gene Monster, I don't know if you remember Mfumo, he's got the big sort of gaping hole in the side of his face. Now he got a type of miasis from the flies, from the blowflies, or either a botfly or unsure, most likely a blowfly, but there are some species of botflies that lay their eggs inside the skin and their larvae will feed on live tissue. Now typically the maggots of flies will feed on decaying tissue, but there's various different types. For instance, blowfly tissue need, blowfly larvae need live tissue to feed for them to survive. And that's something that they can get. So I know it's quite common in cats and dogs and sheep and pigs and things like that to often pick up in sort of intestinal larvae where they'll, whatever they may be eating, they ingest a couple of eggs, their larvae hatches. It can make them a bit sick. It can sort of induce vomiting and diarrhea. But that passes off after a couple of days. It's not life-threatening, perhaps unless the animal is severely dehydrated. And unfortunately, Mfumo, we suspect that he had an injury, a small cut on his face from maybe one of the females when they had a bit of an argument and she swiped him, left a little bit of a gash, and a blowfly or either a botfly, something along those lines, actually physically laid its eggs inside that. And then we saw the maggots hatch and start feeding on his live flesh. So that's something that they can get. But other than that, it's no harm if they eat the odd fly, and I'm sure they do. And I'm sure when there's maggots on the carcass, they probably try and eat around it. At the moment, they've been quite picky, though. Remember, we saw about a week ago, almost maybe 2 weeks ago, we watched the lions go to a carcass filled with maggots, sort of bite it a bit and then move on, go to a second buffalo that hadn't even died yet, sort of play around with him, unfortunately, for a little bit, and then they moved on. Now, like I said, summer will be completely different. If they were to come across a carcass and they hadn't eaten for 4 days, they're going to eat it regardless if it's covered in maggots or not. And then there's a possibility that they're going to ingest a couple of maggots too. Well, it's all protein, but that wouldn't do them too much harm. And that little cub trying to get into some of the juicy bits there. And that lioness is just letting off a subtle growl every now and then. Now, James, you've asked me a question that unfortunately I don't know the answer to. James, you'd like to know if it was two young buffalo that the lions caught. I'm not even sure. I can just see this one buffalo calf here. It's probably just over a year old, maybe even verging on 2 years old. And that's it. I can't see even where the rest of the pride is, but they're in here. They're just in this very dense thicket, but I can't see another carcass, I'm afraid. But when I get an opportunity, I'll try and ask one of the guides. Like I said, the radio communication has not been the greatest, and that's probably a combination of being down in the dips in the drainage and as well as the heat. But they've eaten quite a fair amount of this, so I suspect that the other Nkuhumas have probably got very full bellies. And maybe this lioness was just sort of lying up resting. Maybe she did quite a bit of hard work. And she is now eating her fill. Right, we're going to try and stay here for a little bit longer. Maybe we'll be able to come back and have one last look. But let's go back across to James, and he has finally arrived at Cheetah Plains.
I'm just heading up here, everybody, to see if I can't see something from up here. We're on the southern boundary of Cheetah Plains. I'm now going to look heroic, David. Are you watching? Do I look heroic? Good. The main reason I wanted to come up here was because this looked like a very good seat. Oh, it is very good indeed. This is quite comfortable, everyone. I shall describe it to you, because obviously where you're sitting, you won't be able to quite feel it. Look, the feeling of ants climbing into my short leg is somewhat disconcerting, especially when one thinks about how they're going to bite me shortly in, my inner thigh is quite sensitive, so I think we'll probably move from here. But it is very warm. The soil is warm up here. And there is also some wild asparagus, which I shall bring down to show you. One of the asparagus species. I think it is an asparagus, I'm pretty sure. But I didn't see Nkanyeni or Styx Pride or Quarantine from up there. See, David, I don't think this is the variety that makes your pee-pee smell. That's not too bad, actually. I think it's asparagus. I'm not sure. So I'm just going to spit it out. On the off chance that I'm poisoned myself. One doesn't want to do that. Especially not on a hot day like this, David. You can drive the car, though, can't you? Yes, good. Excellent. On we go. Whew. It's very hot, everybody. It's very hot. I'm glad those lions are finally found. Paul Taylor was sent on a wild goose chase. Now, we're heading into the clearings. We'll see what there is there. That's Mala Mala to the south, to the right. Hello, Darlene. Nice question from you, and I have seen these things myself. We're going into the clearings, which, of course, that's the place that we see ostriches, and you say you've been obviously following the Londolozi blog, and they had 6 ostrich chicks, which I think have all been eaten, if I'm not mistaken. But anyway, you say, if they were to grow up, would they come here? Absolutely, they would. You say, do they roam? They do roam. There is an elephant over there. It's not an elephant, it's that thing with the horns. What's it called again?
Buffalo.
Buffalo, that's it. We'll try and get a view. There are quite a few of them here. It's a whole hoid of them. Darlene, and what you'll find is that because they roam, they will come to and from between clearings like this. So they'd go towards the clearings of Londolozi, come back up here, see what they could find to eat, and absolutely they would roam around. Now that buffalo, astonishingly, despite it being close to 2 of the biggest clearings in the Sabi sand, is browsing, which I think is quite odd, especially as its condition is so very poor. There's one viewer today, everybody, who's being extremely enthusiastic about asking questions. Nikki Austin has something else to say. She wants to know if I have purchased new shorts. This, Nicola, is the latest in bush haute couture. It's called bush blue. I did get new shorts. Thank you, Nikki, for noticing. Now, I don't know if you've noticed this, but the buffalo on Juma, to me, look in far better shape than this bunch. And I think that that's because there's been very little rain here. And this lot, quite unlike the Nyala and the warthogs and various other species, have not sort of congregated around the rainy areas where it has rained. And why they're still here, suffering under the regime of the drought, I'm not really sure. But I will just back that up for you by asking David to turn the, you can have a look there if you want first. And then can we pan off to the right-hand side into Mala Mala? And you can see that it is nothing like as green as Quarantine, for example. You can see it still looks quite desertified. And then there are some wildebeest. They're quite a large herd of wildebeest. Let me count them quickly. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, about 20 of them, plus minus, all the way across there in Mala Mala. So we are now doing what is called illegal viewing, everybody. We are looking at animals on another reserve. We're very naughty. I am, of course, talking utter nonsense. We can look where we want. Right, on we go. The clearing's not far away. And it's nearly lambing or calving season for those wildebeest. So soon we'll have some little ones, I hope. There is an elephant, David. I told you there was an elephant, didn't I? It's making its way down, away from the water at high speed. There it goes. And it's coming towards it. It's a climbing elephant, I hope. Come on, up on top. It's a wonderful sighting, isn't it? Every 5 seconds, you see a flap. There's another one behind it, though, Dave. There we are. I think there's a nice water hole there for them. Now, they will roam quite far. nice. There's another one. Our cup runneth over. And you just, it's always so peaceful to watch them walk, especially if you can't hear them moving. Yesterday, if you weren't watching, David and I had the most astounding elephant sighting with an enormous bull elephant who showed us absolutely no measure of aggression or irritation, but he came within sort of 2 feet of the vehicle or so, and it was just, it was a profound experience. He came walking around here, and then he broke a tree basically where I could touch it, and the only reason we moved off was the second part of the tree was going to fall on David's head, so we headed off from there. He hardly paid us any heed whatsoever. And that's, of course, the best thing. That's why we do what we do. We hope that the animals are not going to react and interact with us. We just want to observe them. And we want them to feel as comfortable as possible around us. I don't see a great swathe of life running through the drainage or running through the clearings here. There's a wildebeest a little closer by. Louise, probably a good idea to do a little test on the comms. Yes, we're still good. We do tend to lose signal with them from here. All right, let's go and have a look at this wildebeest and then we can scan the clearings from there. See if there isn't something spotted lurking on the fringes in the ecotone. Still got you, Louise, still got you. Yes, it is quite humid, I must say. When Taylor said it was humid, I didn't really feel about it. Now, here are some wildebeest. Louise, I'm afraid I missed that last transmission entirely. We're now out of range. You will have to send me a WhatsApp. No, I don't copy. All I hear is bang-dee-dong-bang-bang-bang. So, two wildebeest here. While you look at them, I'm going to scan the clearings with my binoculars. Now, if we were to find a cheetah here, we would find it probably lurking in the shade on the fringes of the clearings, waiting for something unsuspecting to come wandering into them. Then it would break cover and charge them down. But I don't see any such thing around here at the moment. These wildebeest are being tremendously confiding. Hello. Bye. Bang. Bang. Good grief. David, do you know what Louise has just said to me? We're trying something new today. We're on Periscope. Do you know what Periscope is, David?
Yes, I do.
Well, you're a modern man, aren't you? I also know what it is, of course. My good friend Hayden Turner told me. So all of you on Periscope watching us, welcome. It's lovely to have you with us. You can send us a question. I think you can send it probably in some form of comment section. Otherwise, hashtag Safari Live, questions at wildearth.tv, and we'd love to hear from you. Ask us any questions you like. Tell us what you think about what's going on here, and we'll do our best to answer your questions. Wonderful to have you with us on live safari from South Africa, the world's most beautiful country. I'm just going to go up ahead and then up towards another waterhole off to the north of where we are now. North is there. That, of course, makes west behind us, east straight in front of us. And David to the right is?
South.
Well done. South indeed. It's kind of an eerie light, but these clouds, I think, are going to break up before they hit us. Which is very sad, especially before they hit Cheetah Plains, which definitely hasn't had as much rain as we've had at Juma. But there is that strange hot berg northwesterly wind. The It's blowing in from there, and it's quite hot, isn't it? It's quite sort of drying. Yes, got you now, Luisi. All right, in the meantime, while we try and find something living in these wind-swept clearings, Taylor has got something for you, I think, still on Arethusa.
We found an array of animals, and we're going to hopefully show you all of them. We found a little elephant. Now, I'm trying to work out where the adults are. It's just this little one moving around here. And I'm not sure where Mom is. Quite young to be off on its own, but possibly she's in this thicket somewhere around here. Maybe this little one was just so happy feeding on a wisteria, which it was eating, that perhaps it forgot about Mom, and Mom's maybe moved off. It's not too tiny, this elephant. It's quite a few years old. It's probably around maybe between 6 and 8 years old, so it should do all right. And I know that we're trying something new today, by the way, and I'd just like to welcome anybody that's watching on the Periscope Twitter. Not sure what that is, but welcome. And we're very happy to have you here. Now, remember, you're welcome to ask us lots and lots of questions. Myself or James out there, who's driving along on cheetah planes, as you know. You can do that by hashtagging Safari Live on Twitter or sending us an email, questions@wildearth.tv. And we'd love to hear from you. Now, something else I want to show you is I'm just going to bop my head. I want to show you who we've all got here. We've actually just left Arethusa. We're on Triple M. But we've got some giraffe and buffalo too. Isn't that quite exciting? So there's lots to talk about on this stretch of road at the moment. I suspect that we're probably going to spend quite a bit of time here. And I've also been listening out very carefully to see if I can hear any branches breaking of the rest of the herd of this young elephant bull. Now, normally the bulls don't sort of get told to go on their own until they're around anywhere between 16 and 18 years old. Now, this elephant's a little bit young. But like I said, it is possible that he has just got left behind. He's getting to the age where he's going to start exhibiting behavior where he doesn't need his mom anymore and become a little bit more independent. But that's when you typically see a group of the youngsters hanging around together. But he's disappearing, and I'm sure he'll be all right on his own. They're tough, these animals. But let's go up towards the giraffe and the buffalo. But actually, before we do, I've got a couple of go-away birds up in this. Looks like a jackalberry. Let's have a look. Can you see them up there? We'll try and get a bit closer, though. And see if they don't fly away from us. They shouldn't. We're a fair distance off the road. Can even hear a couple shouting in the background. Actually, now this is not even a jackalberry. Sorry, I saw it from a distance. It actually looks like a ginormous silver cluster leaf, which is unusual. We don't typically see massive ones like this. And it seems as though they're just picking off the new shoots. Now, I know there's quite a few giant silver cluster leaf trees that we see on quarantine, actually. And it's quite beautiful. I've never actually seen such big ones before. They always seem to be small and in these little forests. And I'm sure you're wondering what happened to the bright blue sky that we had today, because you can see there's a bit of a grey background now. And about an hour ago, this haze sort of started settling in. The temperature's now cooling down a little bit. And Brian seems to think that we're going to get rained on. Is that still your opinion?
Man, yeah, why not?
Maybe, hey?
Maybe.
It feels like it. I hope we do. Obviously, we're not going to say no to any rain, but we know it's only allowed to rain after 7 o'clock tonight, not 1 minute before. As you can see, the cloud cover is getting quite thick. Well, the weatherman says that there's no rain predicted for today, but we know how wrong the weatherman can be. You can hear an orange-breasted bushshrike. which is quite lovely. But let's go a bit closer to this giraffe that we're seeing in the distance. We're actually quite far away from it. I'm very impressed with the zoom on these cameras. Right, let's go a little closer and see who else we've got. It's a very productive stretch of road. Now, I'm also not certain what happened to Shadow. I can't remember if I heard anything about her this morning. I was obviously so obsessed with Daryl this morning. Haven't seen him yet this afternoon. And something that I was thinking of is, I wonder how many times I said the word Daryl in this morning's game drive. I think I've probably said it more than 200 times, which is quite impressive. Let's go up a bit closer. Oh, and I've got some good news. Hang on, you're going to be so happy now. I saw another elephant. Let's just make everybody smile from ear to ear very quickly, because I was getting a little bit worried. But there's another elephant. Oh, I don't know if you can see it. It's just moving behind that dead tree, to the right of that dead tree. There it is. Can you see it? Now, that is an adult elephant. So as we suspected, I think that that little one had just got slightly separated from the rest of the herd. Isn't that wonderful? Now you don't have to worry and panic like I was, because it seems as though that little elephant is going to be safe and sound. Just being a bit naughty and venturing a little too far away from home, as we know young men do. We'll be coming up to the giraffe. Something else I'm going to go and do today is we're going to go and check on the magpie shrike nest and see how those little chicks are doing. They must be getting quite big quite quickly. Hello, ladies. Oh, lady and gentlemen. Girl. Oh no, we didn't mean to scare you. She stood still for that whole time and I thought I did a very good job at coming in quietly. It's funny how this giraffe is a little bit nervous of us, but we've got one right in front, which we'll show you in a moment. Well, she can't be too nervous because she just licked her nose for all of you. You see she's staring at us now, trying to suss out what we are. Now, I always wonder if it's perhaps not that aerial that makes him sort of think, what on earth is that? I'd be a little bit scared of it. And then now you can see we've got one right in front of us that doesn't really mind us at all. And this is a young male. You can see still lovely light and color, of course. Now he's moving off slightly. Oh, he's coming towards us. This is exciting. Hello. Not too close, he's just going off to the side now, but much more relaxed than that female giraffe. And he's going to get there. He's still very young. I reckon he's probably not more than about, maybe he's between 12 and 15 years old, somewhere around there. He's just starting to go a little bit darker, and he's feeding on a variety of trees. He was feeding on a buffalo thorn just a moment ago, and now he's feeding on a bush willow. Very tasty. It seems as though the female in the back is now settled down, because this male hasn't showed any signs that he's uncomfortable with us, and hopefully she will feed off of his behavior. But what a lovely sight that is. Yes, it's okay, girl. We won't bite you. What I've actually noticed that I think looks quite cool, and maybe you'll agree with me, is look at his mane. You see how it's all sort of finely combed at the top? And sort of quite beautiful with all those bristles. And then as soon as you go further down towards the wither, it becomes quite spiky. And I wonder what's caused that. The hair doesn't look as sort of neat and tidy. Maybe it's got a bit wet or something. Maybe there's saliva on it and it's all stuck together. And we've just got these two here, just a young male and a female who looks well mature. And this is quite typical. I've actually just seen another I've seen two more giraffe popping out. Oh my goodness, there's quite a few of them coming this way, but I think they're going to actually come right towards us. We'll watch them. Another female looks like she's going to pop out in front of the road. There's another one disappearing off, which I can't quite tell who it is. Now, James, you were commenting and saying that you know how the giraffe have a very loose sort of structure when it comes to their herd. You were wondering, when the females are close to giving birth, do they sort of join up with other females sort of for safety? It seems as though there's actually 5 giraffe here now. Now, that's definitely a possibility. However, I've had a different experience. They'll sort of stay in the herds, you know, like we often see the females. And then what I have seen, and I told the story this morning where when I hadn't even started guiding, I was doing my training. I watched the giraffe giving birth, and what had happened was she just moved off. She moved away from the herd to go and give birth. And once she'd given birth, then the rest of the herd actually came towards her. So I think in the sense that they sort of do then stick together, but they move off, like we see with the impala, living in herds together. When they give birth, they disappear. They don't give birth in the middle of the herd. They go and find a bit of brush, a bit of shelter, obviously because those little lambs are quite vulnerable, and the same thing with the giraffe calf, as they can be quite vulnerable too. Let's go up a little bit further. It's quite interesting. There's a nice journey of giraffe, and I know that there's another vehicle behind me, and I'm sure that they're probably trying to come past us. So I just want to pull off the road slightly. Let's do this so that they can squeeze past. We're now going to get the perfect bum shot of a giraffe. I've had to park at an interesting point just so that Shanae can pass us if she'd like to. I suppose I can't hog up the entire road. Hello, big boy. And he's a very obliging giraffe. Normally when we see them, they do tend to move off quite a bit and not hang around for very long. But he doesn't seem to mind us at all. He's really enjoying this bushwell. And now we see the giraffe eating a variety of tree species. Obviously we know that they prefer to eat acacias. But unfortunately, we don't see too many acacias around here. There's the odd one here and there, but they're not prolific. For instance, in the Eastern Cape, we had the acacia karoo, or the sweet thorn acacia, and they were very prominent in the Albany Thicket. There were forests of them all over the Eastern Cape, not just on reserves, but we used to have them even in the garden. And they absolutely loved to eat those acacias. Oh my goodness, we're just surrounded by giraffe this afternoon. Isn't this quite spectacular to have the tallest creature walking right next to you? And off he goes again. As we watch him masticate, and well, if you don't know what masticate means, it means chew. As we watch him chew his food with his mouth open, which my mother would be very disappointed in, I believe that James has got another kind of bovid out there on Cheetah Plains.
I think it is the only bovid, if I'm not mistaken, and there it is again, the same buffalo, well, not the same buffalo, but same species as the buffalo we saw earlier. Now, what I want you to try and do, Darvy, is get, see the one to the left, second from the left. If you can super zoom in on its backside, that'd be great. Now, this is a slightly grim thing to tell you, but if you tilt down slightly, Dave, you can see there. Now, a buffalo normally has a fairly spectacular set of, testicles, really. And these ones do not. They're not old at all. They're old enough to have that fairly spectacular set of testicles, but they don't have them. And it's interesting because I think buffalo, in adverse conditions, allow their testicles to kind of atrophy. They sort of take them up into the body. They lose weight completely. And I think that's what's happened here. So they're not, the body is very cleverly not wasting energy on something that is non-essential to survival. And this, in fact, the one to the right is exactly the same. He's a bit older than the others. He's very ribby. You can see his hips all over the place. Far to the right there, Davy. There, that one. No, not even that one, even further to the right. The furthest one right that you can, there we go. Can see certainly a mature bull, but he looks ropey. And he's got not much of an undercarriage, and that is because the body's allowed it to atrophy in order to save energy expenditure. I think that's really quite clever. We often see it with the older bulls, but I mean, with that you'd kind of expect it. But with the youngsters, I think it's unusual. Okay, we're going to go with them to the water. They are going towards three in a row pan. I can see others converging from the sort of straight in front of us there, and then some more converging from the right. There's going to be a conference, a beefalo conference, David. And elephants coming too. Can you see the elephants, Dave? Good. Get out of the way, Beefy. Go on. Yes, I know you've had a tough time. I'm not here to be your psychologist. Ah. There are three elephants coming down to drink. There's a whole convergence. It's like there's some kind of sort of conference going on here. Buffalo coming from the left, elephants from the right. Let's watch and see if there's any conflict between the elephants and the buffalo. Elephants not very good at sharing their water. Another buffalo coming from that side. Big herd coming from the left. Elephants actually not stopping for a drink at all. Just on the road to somewhere else. I wonder where they're going. This water is very dirty, of course. And elephants are notoriously fussy about the water they drink. So perhaps it's just that they know of a cleaner water source somewhere around here. They're heading sort of directly towards Jacobin Camp. But the buffalo, not so fussy about the water they drink. Look at this long line of them coming in from the left, Dave, once you've looked at those ones. Here we have a long breeding herd. It's exactly what it is, Mac and Weezer. Mac and Weezer, you say this is a water cooler meeting in the afternoon. It is. That's exactly what it seems to be. And you know, it's so funny. We came past here. There wasn't a sausage around except the rotting carcass of one of the buffalo in the other pan. But now suddenly you get the timing right and here they are. That elephant, did you hear that?
Yep.
The elephant just made a very loud rumbling noise, but it wasn't very deep. It was kind of almost like a saw. Normally it's almost too deep for us to hear. Now this is a small breeding herd of buffalo, for those of you who are wondering, everybody. This is not a large herd at all. What I'm going to do is just move the vehicle a little bit so we can get a slightly better view of them drinking. And like I said to you yesterday, I think, or the day before, or whenever it was, I think things have gone beyond the stage, certainly things had gone beyond the stage where the herds would congregate as they would normally in the dry season. We've got to the stage now where resources have become so thin on the ground that those big herds have become very small now as they search for sufficient to eat. Unfortunately, these two think I'm trying to herd them. There we go. Should get a lovely picture now of them in the water. There we go. Get my fat bonce out of the way. Oh, very interesting question from James Dungan about catfish and whether there would be some dormant eggs in the mud. Yeah, there could be, except that I would expect there to be catfish here by now because this has now been wet for a couple of weeks. And maybe there are some very small catfish there. I mean, there's certainly plenty of terrapins. They've emerged from somewhere. But I mean, how a buffalo can drink this I just don't understand. It's largely mud. There's not a great deal of water in it. But they don't seem to mind at all. So, James Dungan, I imagine there must be some dormant catfish eggs here. Whether there are little catfish that have hatched out and are now living on the algae that will be growing here, I'm sure that's what they'd start out eating, and probably the odd mosquito larvae. I wish I'd eat more mosquito larvae. Never seen so many mosquitoes as I have this year. But I certainly don't see any obvious signs of catfish, James. I was wondering what that elephant was shouting at. It wouldn't have been the buffalo. I wonder if it wasn't perhaps a predator of some sort behind us. We'll go have a look-see now. Well, yes. Very good point, Marisha. You say perhaps they're coming together from meeting this lot in order to avoid a meeting with the Nkuhuma Pride, who, if you don't know, have killed roughly 40 buffalo in the last 40 days. It's not quite that many. It's probably about 30 in 40 days. It's quite astounding. And they killed two last night, I believe. All right, are we going to move on from here? Simply because I want to see what that elephant was shouting at. And if we don't see what that was, we might catch the elephants as they come out onto the road that way. Here's the path that they took. Yeah, you can see very obvious there. She just made a very kind of alarmed call. Nicola has left us, everybody. She's going off to do, I don't know what it is. She says she has to go, she had to run. Perhaps that means she's got work to do, or she's going for a run. Either way, nice to talk to you, Nicola, and we'll talk to you again. There is the dead buffalo. I said we wouldn't show it to you, but I think we're going to anyway. We'll check on the maggots. How are the maggots doing there, Dave? Yes, that buffalo is not alive, is it? Can't see anything, certainly. That would have been a bird that took its eye. Let's have a quick look at the maggots at the back there. Are they still living? Oh, yes, they are. They're having a wonderful time. Mmm, beautiful. Does that make you hungry, David? Mmm, me too. It is a seething mass. That is that must be where the expression seething mass comes from, because that right there is a seething mass. Full frame maggots, very nice. And their parents in the background. The regal blowfly. Dawn, very nice comment from you there in Michigan as we look at David's skillful panning over the seething mass of maggots. You say, our cameramen are so good that have any of them won any awards? I'm not aware of any. David, have you won any awards?
I'm afraid not.
Oh, no. That's just because you haven't entered any competitions. But I agree with you, Dawn. There's two things that are quite on a serious note about that. The first is that nobody does this kind of thing. We're the only people in the world that do basically live wildlife broadcasting. And the techniques for doing the live stuff, I think, as David will attest, are very different to them doing the kind of traditional documentary type of thing. And so if you were to take a showreel of the live stuff and compare it with, say, a blue chip documentary footage, you'd probably find that somebody who didn't know what the live stuff was about would be quite critical of what these guys do, because they move with animals, they never let them leave the shot, they zoom and pan and tilt and on a continuous shot, which you wouldn't necessarily do, you know, if you were filming a traditional documentary. So it's very, very different stuff. But I think they're fantastic as well. Thank you, Dawn. I, of course, have to say that because David will refuse to film anything but the sky unless I compliment him in that way. The elephant path comes out onto the road over here, and I'm hoping we'll get another view. Now, interesting, from Mary Eleanor, I was chatting about the number of buffalo that have been taken down by the Ngahumas, and you're wondering, Mary Ellen, if that is going to make a difference to the grass. Will it help the grass sort of recover? The answer is yes, to a certain extent it will. Remember that, I mean, a huge number of animals die, I guess, of old age, or die of natural causes and disease and that sort of thing. And so although the Ngahumas have killed 30 of them in the last little while, that will certainly make some difference to the grass recovery, but I think you'll find that drought has probably indirectly killed far more than that over the course of the last little while, and that will almost certainly help the grass from a fertilization point of view and from a rest point of view. Now we're going to go to one more waterhole on Cheetah Plains, and then we're going to head back to Juma, because other than buffalo and three elephants, there ain't a great deal going on out here. It's funny how that works. I was really rather hoping to find Quarantine and Inkanyeni. And I really want to compare the size of Quarantine to his older brother, Shivambalani, who we saw the other day. And I think Quarantine's bigger, even though he's 2 years younger. Which is very unusual indeed. David, I think you described Quarantine as a bit of a beast, didn't you? He's a big fellow. Which is interesting, because his father is not very big. Must get it from one of his grandfathers. Ah, we found another buffalo, David. Oh no, we haven't, it's a log. Never mind, everyone. There's a very dark log just inside there. Ooh, we don't often get this opportunity. A very good question from you, and I'm not sure I know the answer, so why don't I ascend this termite mound in order to get some leaves off this brown ivy tree to show them to you. I will think about it. You say, why were there no mongoose or birds eating those maggots? Well, I think there were no mongoose because it's muddy and watery, and I think they'd drown if they tried to eat there. And secondly, the birds, I don't know why there wouldn't be birds there. But I mean, you seldom see birds actually at a kill site. Even if it's not in the water, you seldom see them eating the maggots, which is quite interesting. I've never thought about it. Thank you, Aqua, for confusing me completely on this hot day. There's a spider hunting wasp. Thought it was going to hunt me for a second. This is a brown ivory, everybody. Berkemia discolor, and you can see there the very, very distinctive venation. Looks sort of herringbone venation is what we call it. And if you ever see that herringbone venation and you're on safari here in Africa, well, you know it's an ivory, either red or brown. This is the brown one. It's growing on the termite mound, along with I don't know what along with. I think it's a false marula. Beautiful. Isn't it lovely? Very nice. When one doesn't have animals, one must look at trees. On we go. Plug in. There we go. Now, those of you who are watching on the Periscope Twitter test, we're going to bid you a fond farewell. Thank you for watching. Join us, if you'd like to, wildsafarilive.com. Otherwise, I'm sure we'll Periscope again if this one was successful. David, up in the top of that tree. European bee eaters, everybody. Well done, Dave. I stopped too late. We haven't had a good sighting of them, or I haven't this year. I know we have seen them, though. Right, Taylor is back on Juma, everybody. I'm not sure what she's got. Let's go and find out what her plans are for the rest of the afternoon.
So, like James said, we are definitely back on Juma. And what I thought we would go and do is perhaps we're on Vuyatela access at the moment. Let's pop past the Juma pan and see what's happening there and see if there's maybe any elephant or buffalo or a hippo. And then, well, we'll probably go and check that old buffalo carcass that the lions took down yesterday and go see if there's any vultures around there, just because we didn't get to spend too much time with the vultures. But a drive is not complete. Like a drive is not complete without impala, it's also not complete without a lilac-breasted roller, which we have got over here. Hello, roller. Now, obviously, it's quite difficult to see these against the grey sky. And I think it has just eaten something, the way that it is opening and closing its mouth like that. What's your next move? There's lots of dragonflies around at the moment, so I wonder if that's what the birds aren't preying on. Especially something like a roller, the purple rollers, of course, or the lilac-breasted rollers. Even the drongos, they're very much acrobatic in the sky. And they are able to utilize and catch very fast-moving insects. And let's see what your next move is going to be. They're very quick. It's landing. Oh, what's on the ground? Termites. Oh, it looks like, is it ants or termites carrying something? Can you see all those things? I can just see them walking around with bits of grass. Perhaps they are harvester termites. And that would make a lot of sense because the harvester termites go out and collect bits of grass and sort of cut them off, and then they bring them to their hole, the entrance of the hole. There's a dragonfly I was talking about. And I think that's exactly what that's eating. Well, you better gobble all those termites up because they're very good for you. Now, this is what you call essentially a buffet. And I'm sure some of those termites will make it back to their mound without being gobbled up by this lilac-breasted roller. You're going to be so full after this. You're not going to be able to fly anywhere. You're going to have to just walk around. But a delicious and nutritious meal nonetheless. Is anybody counting how many termites that this lilac-breasted roller has eaten? I didn't. I should have, though. That could have been another little experiment we could have done today. How many termites does it take to fill a lilac-breasted roller? Perhaps we'll have to start again next time, or maybe one of you were counting. But you can see that crop is starting to get full now. It's starting to bulge just a little bit. Sort of just below the purple throat. Oh, it's moving around. Have you seen something bigger? No. Done with the termites. Wasn't that incredible to see? This is a very obliging lilac-breasted roller, I must say. One of the better sightings I've had of this stunning bird. And even just to see them for a brief moment is usually quite amazing. But to see them flying from branch to branch and then landing and eating almost quite a few termites. And off it goes. Look at those beautiful colors that come through. And into the distance, it disappears. That was incredible. Yes, Louise just described this sighting as gorgeous. Those were her exact words. How do you spell that, Louise? Gorgeous. All right, we're going to carry on. We're going to do what we said. We're going to head towards the pan and see what we got. Oh, elephants. Gorgeous. Louise, that's a very interesting way to spell that word. But it seems as though we don't have to go to the pan to find elephants this afternoon. The elephants have found us, and here they are. Hi, guys. Oh, there's lots of little ones here. This is nice. I'm going to go up a little bit further, though. And there's actually quite a few things I want to show you. The sky is going to be one of them with the elephants. So I'm going to park over here. Let me go a little bit further forward. Here we go. Look at that. Elephants, the sky, the Drakensberg mountain range that you can just see in the distance. That is absolutely lovely. And those clouds have lifted now, but there's still a slight haze in the sky. I think this might make for a very beautiful sunset once the sun dips behind that very thick wall of cloud that you can see on the top. And I think these other little clouds are going to illuminate quite nicely. So I hope you're ready and waiting for the sunset this evening. We've got a lovely breeding herd of elephants, though, moving through this open plain, which is quite nice. I always love it when the elephants come out into the open, especially when you've got a scene like that. Now, that would be a very nice screensaver, so I suggest taking a couple of screenshots, and I'd love to see something like this. I mean, this is a photographer's dream. It's not always that you get a beautiful skyline with mountains and colorful clouds and, of course, well, the most fantastic creature on Earth. This is, of course, my opinion. It looks like some of them have maybe had a drink at some point. This one elephant on the left, her trunk looks a little bit darker than the rest of her body. So maybe there was a little mud wallow. You can see her front legs are a bit wet too. Maybe there was a little mud wallow, or pan of water somewhere that they've had a drink at. Or maybe it was from much earlier today and she's actually drying off. We've got that youngster feeding underneath the guari bush. What are you eating? I thought it was maybe getting the longer bits of grass that are growing underneath there. That one also looks like it's got a wet trunk. No, what are you eating? I can't see what this little one is eating. There's some sort of vegetation that's growing under there, and it seems to be quite a young plant because it just pulled it out and the roots came with it. That one was a bit trickier, had to use its foot to help sort of lever it out of the sand. Hello, beautiful. You can see that they did definitely have a mud bath, possibly earlier today. You can see all that, those crusty bits on the knees and behind the ears and on the back. No, that wasn't too tasty. I just can't get over that view. That is beautiful. And it's just moments like these that we need to sort of take in and really just appreciate how lucky we are. And she's feeding almost right up to the vehicle. I'm sure she'll probably turn away if she doesn't feel too comfortable, but at the moment, she's very much relaxed. She's just flapping her ears to try and keep herself nice and cool. Well, these elephants actually look relatively healthy, and I know that MMP was wondering, do we ever intervene with the animals if they get sick or of injury? Now, we try and do and intervene as little as possible. So in terms of the animals getting sick, if it's a disease that's natural in the area, well, then we sort of let nature take its course. The only time we intervene is when an animal is injured due to human interference. So, for example, is watching this. Ellie, as she comes closer. Hello, girl. Uh-uh. Hello. Oh, you're just coming to get that little thing. Oh, that's fine. You go for it. You eat all of those little plants that you're eating. Sorry, I'll answer your question now. It may seem silly as well that I'm talking to the elephants, but Brian and I are firm believers that you should always talk to the elephants because they talk back to you. Isn't that correct, hey, Brian?
Yeah. If you don't talk to the animals, they won't talk back to you.
There we go. That's what I like. So as I was saying, I get distracted quite often, but I try and come back to what I was trying to say in the beginning. Now, if, for instance, an elephant was walking around and it unfortunately got its trunk or foot stuck in a snare, something like that, we would definitely intervene. So if you're wondering what a snare is, it's a type of a piece of hunting equipment that people will use to try and catch smaller animals, like antelope, for food. But it's usually made out of wire, and sometimes a curious elephant or even a lion could put their foot or their head inside it. Then we will dart the animal and remove something like a snare and treat it. And if it's from a gunshot wound, from poaching or anything along those lines where it's humans that have caused the injury to the animal, we will assist them. Otherwise, we let nature take its course. It's important to let diseases come through and control populations of animals. The same thing with droughts. It's important we don't feed them. They've got more than enough of an area to move around. Now, she's a young cow that we're looking at. I don't think she's even had her first calf just yet. She hasn't got any swelling in her mammary glands, and it doesn't look like there's a little calf developing inside of her. I think she's a little bit young. She's probably around just shy of about between 10 and 12 years, maybe even slightly older than that. And I reckon she could have her first calf probably after about 15 years. It depends on each animal, though. Hello, Jackie's class, who's watching in Illinois. Now, you were wondering, or commenting first, on how flexible the elephant's trunk is, and you're quite right in that, and you're wondering if there are any bones inside of there. Now, there aren't any bones inside of this trunk. There's just lots and lots of muscles. They estimate that there's about 60,000 muscles in that elephant's trunk, large muscles and small muscles, which they'll have to train, and I'm sure there's a little bit of cartilage as well, but nothing else. It really is just a very, very large and powerful muscle. And that's why when you see those little elephants waving their trunks around, sort of like they've got no control of them, well, they don't. For the first year of their life, they really struggle to use them. And it's important that they swing them around and try and pick up things, because they start strengthening the various muscles to perform certain actions. I always laugh when they try and drink water. That's probably the hardest one, is trying to suck the water up through their trunk and then hold it there so that they can squirt it back into their mouth. Often they'll get the sucking up process right, and then they go to squirt it in their mouth. But before it's in their mouth, they've squirted it all on the ground. So that takes a little bit of practice. Now, we're seeing these elephants eating a lot of leaves at the moment and digging up bulbs from the ground. Now, Saturn, you were wondering if elephants can eat and digest grass like cows. So elephants have got a very different digestive system to a cow. A cow has got, or is a ruminant, so they have a four-chambered stomach. Whereas elephants, they don't have that. They've got one big chamber where all the food goes in, and they only digest 40% of their food, and that's why their feces, their dung, is so large, whereas cows is sort of in a little bit of a pancake. But if you sift through very dry cow dung, you see it's almost like powder. It's so fine. And that's because when you are a ruminant, your digestive system is very, very good. Now, unfortunately, like I said, elephants don't have a great digestive system, but they do enjoy eating grass. When there is grass around, they'll actually favor that rather than feeding on the leaves. But lucky for us, and lucky for the elephants, they're able to eat a variety of different things. They dig for roots and bulbs underneath the ground. They'll strip the bark and try and get to the cameum layer off the inside of the tree, and they'll munch on that as well. Isn't that amazing? Let's go up a little bit closer, though. Let's just reposition slightly, because I think they're just about to disappear off into the thicket. So let's try and get a view of a couple of others that are still coming across the road. Nope. There they are. They're actually forming a roadblock. Now, David, you've asked if the elephants can get mange, and obviously we've been speaking quite a bit about mange over the last few months, really. Actually, since I've started working here, and probably prior to that. And that's because the lions, unfortunately, in this area seem to have a bout of it. Now, David, I'm not sure if they do. I've never seen a case of elephants with mange, and I wonder if that's because they don't have too much hair covering their bodies. Remember, mange is a mite, a parasite that actually feeds on the hair follicle. And elephants are covered in hair, but not the same amount that we see on cats and dogs and impala and all the various the other animals around here. So I don't think that there's enough sort of food to sustain something like mange. I don't think they do. I think there are various other skin conditions that elephants can contract as well. Not sure of any off of the top of my head, but there's always possibilities. Look how they're able to use that trunk. That's amazing. Right. These elephants have been absolutely wonderful. I think let's jump across to James, and if I'm not mistaken, he's also got something with tusks.
Not hippopotamus, everybody, no, but pigs. David, are these your favourite animal?
Close to.
Close, they're pretty close to everybody's, I think. Anyway, this is a very noisy sounder. I'm just going to be quiet for a second. And they kind of stopped doing it, but the two little ones were sort of talking to each other. They were going... I don't know what they were saying. Well, that's what they were doing. And they are putting on condition in a fine, fine way, very quickly indeed, loving the new grass. And I suppose, unlike the buffalo, you know, I was talking to David about this as we drove through after countless buffalo on cheetah plains while you were looking at the elephants. And many of them browsing, reaching into the trees, almost like goats to try and get at the grass, at least at the leaves. And I think that they are, you know, they're adapted for eating long grass. And I think the short grass in those clearings is A, too short, and B, it's interspersed with forbs, sort of aromatic annual plants that I guess are just not very good for buffalo to eat. And I think they really struggle to get to the short stuff. Whereas the pigs, of course, are completely perfectly designed to get at the short grass. And they'll go down on their knees if they have to. They've got that very short or hard snout for digging. And a much less sort of fussy diet. Much more Catholic diet, as we call it. Oh, James, you want to know how many buffalo I think have been lost to the drought? I couldn't begin to tell you, I'm afraid. I've got no idea. Kruger wide, I'm sure, well over 1,000. And depends whether you know, how you count them. Are they direct deaths from starvation, or are they perhaps deaths from predation because they got weak? So how many have died as a result of the drought would be almost impossible to say. Unless you knew of every single buffalo in the Kruger Park area, which of course is impossible. Almost impossible. Another nice sort of juxtaposition of colours there. The yellow in the background of that leaf, or pale green, and then the green of the senna, we call it, that's the plant that you can see, the monkey pod, and then the dark grey of the wortees. two little brothers, born no doubt to the same litter, and a very nice telegraph pole in the middle. Goodness, Ricea, this is a long time since I've heard your name. Wonderful to have you with us. I'm sure you watch. I don't know if you're watching all the time, but perhaps you just haven't sent through many questions of late or comments. And you say you reckon that all of the grazers are looking pretty ropey, that none of them have put on much condition. Yeah, I tend to agree. The buffalo certainly haven't put on very good condition, nor have the impala. The elephants have. I think they've definitely managed to put on quite a lot of condition since the rains. The warthogs, I don't think they ever lost a huge amount, the warties. I think they've looked pretty good from the beginning. They're looking a little bit skinny, but they don't look too bad. I'm just trying to think what else. The nyala look pretty good. In fact, all the browsers seem to look pretty good. But the impala, not so good for some reason. And I think it's probably a lot more complicated than whether they eat tree leaves or grass leaves. It's probably got something to do with the compounds in the plants that they eat and the much more selective nature of their diets than we think they are. In the background, a cuckoo. Ooh, 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 ooh. That doesn't sound anything like a cuckoo. See? That warthog thinks I'd do a very good cuckoo call, David. You see that? All right, let's ease slowly along. Oh, now, Jimmy, you're wondering about the taste of warthog. The taste of warthog, you want to know, is it like that of domestic hawk? No, it isn't. It's much more delicious. It's much less... I guess it's got a slight tang of pork to it, but it's not taste strongly of pork. It tastes a little bit like pork mixed with chicken, mixed with a bit of lamb, I suppose. It's very flavoursome, very tender, very nice indeed. Right, Taylor apparently has got a brilliant vision of the sun, which is doubly impressive as the sun isn't going down yet.
We do. Brian and I were right this afternoon. We said it was going to be a lovely sunset, though it hasn't set just yet. We're a little bit early, but I thought that I would just show you nonetheless, especially while we've got such a nice view of the Drakensberg Mountains. It's quite spectacular. And we'll just take a couple of moments just to really enjoy and take in this wonderful wilderness that we have been sort of blessed to see. Isn't that incredible? You've just got a wall of clouds and then just coming out in that small gap between the Drakensberg Mountains and that thick wall of clouds, the sun just peeping through now. And we know how quickly the sun sets. I think that is absolutely stunning. Those colors, the golden colors, that sort of dark, almost looks like grey, black, I don't even know how to describe that colour, but it's just so beautiful. And I'd really like to just wait just until that sun sort of pokes its head through this wall of clouds. Well, speaking about the density of clouds that we have, I know that Raisa was wondering how much rain we've had in the past 7 days. We've actually had quite a bit, Raisa. I'm still uncertain as to exactly how much we had the other day, but I reckon we've had around 30 mils, which is nice. I thought we would have seen a little bit more improvement of the grass coming through, but perhaps the earth is just so thirsty that it's absorbing it all before the roots are really getting any. It's green, which is good, and there is a little bit of grass around, but it's at that very awkward stage where it's quite short. So something like an elephant is unable to feed on it. Even a buffalo, I think, would struggle to try and munch away on this grass that we're seeing in this area. But for the impala, it should be okay, and perhaps some of the other antelope species, they might be able to munch a couple of blades. Here it comes. Here comes the sun. Slowly but surely. I mean, you just look at that, those very black clouds, and you just think that how can something beautiful come from behind that? That's what I just think is so incredible. Look how quickly it's coming down. Oh my goodness, wow. It is almost too bright to look at with the naked eye. Oh my goodness, look how the colors are changing now. From that bright yellow to almost a red tinge. Wow. And it's moments like these where I really just don't have anything to say, because I don't think words do a sighting like this justice. That is going to be absolutely incredible. You can see the colors of the clouds now starting to change with all the dust around. We'll have one last look at the sunset, and then perhaps we'll catch it again when it really is about to disappear behind the horizon. Maybe we'll see it from quarantine. I think that that's always quite a nice spot. Isn't that lovely? Oh my goodness, look at the golden light that is coming off of that. I really just want to show you what's happened all of a sudden from being sort of gray and glum and not very bright at all. It's changed completely out here. And you probably see the light, how it's radiating just onto me. It is unbelievable, a photographer's dream. But let's carry on up ahead. And like I said, we were definitely going to have another look at the sunset in a couple of minutes though. While we make our way towards quarantine and the pan, let's go across on James's vehicle and see how him and David are doing.
There is a water buck, everybody, and the light has just turned golden, and so I think we'll stop and have a look and a smell at the water buck. Oh, I like the smell. Now, and some more wildebeest. Goodness gracious, our cup doth run over. Let's watch the waterbuck first, which are running away slightly. Lovely light catching them. I've often tried to describe the smell as sort of, I guess, sweet musky leather, a bit of peat thrown in there. But I had a very small glass of very special whiskey last night called Talisker. It was a very famous Scotch from the Isle of Skye. Well, waterbuck don't smell dissimilar to Talisker. Have you ever had Talisker, David? Did I not give you any? Oh, well, I shall try and give you some, David, but it smells not unlike waterbuck. Now, there's some wildebeest up ahead, also in the golden light. We'll try and get into a position where we can see them. We have seen 3 or 4 herds of wildebeest today, which I think is unusual for this area. Look, we're not approaching East African numbers by any stretch, but still, there we go. I'm going to make a confession, everybody. I think that our wildebeest up here, the blue gnu, He's a slightly better looking individual than the brindled gnu of East Africa. I quite like the dark beards as opposed to the blonde ones. And the cows here, you can see, are very heavily pregnant. Very fat indeed. These guys look very good. The zebra also haven't lost any condition, right? So I think they're looking pretty good too. Now, Taylor was showing you the sunset. What I'm going to do, David, is try and create art, and you can tell me if you think it's art or not. We're going to get those wattled starlings in the tree with the sun behind them. Oh, isn't it pretty, David? So pretty. Look at that, everybody. Isn't that lovely? I'm so artistic, David. Ah, that's stunning. And in the background, you can hear, of course, the cicada. Gorgeous sound of the cicada. Something on the road up ahead. Hang on, you stay watching that, David. I'll check on the road. More impala. I'm gobsmacked with surprise. Yo, that is something else. Ah, now Louise says our sunset is better than Taylor's. Well, you know, it's just experience, you know, David. I'm 16 years older than Taylor, of course, which means, well, I've just got that much more experience, don't I? Now, David, I'm going to ask you to do something very special. If you can. Oh, wait. Oh, yes, okay. Now we're in it now. There's a fallen stick there. Okay, can you see the stick there? There, I'm scratching. There. That's it. There's a spider hunting wasp, everyone. And it is not flying, which means it's not impossible to follow with a camera. And it is looking for David.
A spider,
yes. Unsurprisingly, it is looking for a spider. And it's looking specifically for a baboon spider, which to the rest of you, or to many who live in the New World, will recognize as a tarantula. And we get various kinds of little tarantulas here, none quite so intimidating as the ones you might find in your sleeping bag of a camping evening in the Amazon. But that's what she's looking for. There she is. Middle of frame. Left. Up. There. See, a beautiful starling-coloured bird. And when they fly, Now, when she catches the spider, of course, I'm not sure if Taylor told you this, because I know she was looking at one also. And what they had, of course, or what they do is they paralyse the baboon spider, lay their eggs in it, and the baboon spider lies there, knowing that its fate is going to end very soon. And then the larvae of the wasp hatch inside the baboon spider and eat it from within. On that note, let's head across to Taylor, who's got something more cheerful to tell you.
Got a beautiful elephant. James, I don't know what was I supposed to say. I feel like I'm under pressure all of a sudden. We've got this big elephant bull, though, who's munching away on a larch-fruited bush willow. And he's quite a large elephant. Not ginormous tusks. Hello, boy. Let's see if he's going to turn. Hello, big man. Look at that lovely light that's coming on him. Just flapping his ears because he's hot, don't worry. Look at that light. Isn't that absolutely gorgeous? It's okay, big boy. Now, were you chasing a hippopotamus around? Because I believe that that's the rumor. And if that's so, that's very naughty. Because that hippopotamus is about the fifth of your size, and I don't think that's very fair. And you are behaving like a classic bully, my friend. You better change your attitude. We'll go and have a look and see how the hippopotamus is doing, of course. And we might have to do some therapy. And just reassure that hippo that everything will be all right. He's a big elephant, though. And you can see that he's very easily able to just pull and break these branches as he wills, as he will. This is so amazing. This afternoon has just been so fantastic. It's just been very peaceful. I don't know if anybody else feels the same. I feel very relaxed, sort of stress-free, nothing to worry about. Look at those Inyala as well doing their dance and just behind the elephant. You can see that they've erected all their hair. Now the one on the left was actually doing the dance better, but now he's stopped. Oh, I thought we were going to see the Inyala prance. Obviously not today though. Off you go, Mr. Elephant. Isn't this wonderful? Now, I wouldn't like to be standing in that tree. If you were a caterpillar or a beetle, you'd be being shook around at the moment. He sort of pulls the branches and then lets go. And, well, they fling to the other side. I'm waiting for an insect to land in the vehicle. There's another little elephant as well. When I say little, little in comparison to this giant. Hello, Marianne from Arkansas. So you were chatting about one of the beautiful nocturnal creatures that we're starting to see again, which is chameleons. And you're wondering, where do they go when you don't see them during the day? Well, now in the summer months, they actually just be sitting on the branches, in and amongst, or maybe even on the trunks of the trees. But because there's so many leaves now, it's very, very difficult to see them. But I found a couple of chameleons during the day. So that's sort of just where they go in these summer months. And then as the night sort of cools down a little bit, they then come to the edge of the trees and just sort of perch themselves there. Now, this is going to be an interesting reaction. Actually, I wonder if this is not the bull that was maybe chasing the hippo around. They look like they're going to have a standoff. See if I can roll. No, I can't roll forward. I don't want to disturb them. But this is definitely not an even match. They're looking at each other, deciding what they're going to do next. They're probably going to hook. I'm going to see. They don't seem too bothered by me. Brian, I'm just going to go forward just a couple of meters. No, they're not bothered by me. I'm going to give them a bit of room. Look at this. This is incredible. Now, that younger bull, I think he knows his place, though. He came up almost sort of quite aggressively, I would say. His whole posture about him wasn't submissive when he came towards this elephant. And naturally, the larger bull then responded and took a couple of steps forward towards him. And they greeted with their trunks, and they've settled down for the moment. You can see the bull on the closest to us is now resting his trunk over his tusks. Let's see, no, he's not taking any of his nonsense and his previous attitude. He's sort of ushering him along, just reminding him that size does matter. And he's obviously the big boss around here. You haven't met Daryl. Daryl is bigger than you, mister. Look at that elephant's tail swatting against his trunk, and he didn't like that too much. He sort of poked him with his tusks and said, keep on going. Now, Velpine Wolf Girl, you've mentioned actually quite an amazing comment. You've said, do you think that elephants will eat the occasional insect while they're feeding? I think they do. I definitely think when they break sort of the younger branches off and pop them in their mouths whole, I'm sure that there'll be the odd beetle or perhaps a little caterpillar or ant or something along the line on those leaves, and well, then they just get sort of devoured. So I think that definitely happens. This bull on the right is very cheeky. I think he's smelling. Let's see if one of them is going to put that. No, we're going to have a push and shove. I mean, you can see the size difference, even just from the trunk. You can see the elephant's trunk on the right is nowhere near as long as the one on the left. There's probably about 10 years age difference between these two ellies. Look at that. I mean, you can see even the thickness of the trunk. This younger bull is no match for the one on the left. He's got life experience on his side, and he's got size on his side. Are they greeting? See how they pop their trunks in their mouth? That's very typical. And often, like what this elephant on the left is trying to do, they'll put their trunks and rest them on their opponent's forehead. But this is nothing serious. This is them greeting, having a bit of a push and shove around. But the older one will assert his dominance over the youngster, like I said, just to remind him that he is the boss and that he needs to be respected. You see, they're getting pushed right out of the way, but nothing too aggressive. These elephant bulls probably wouldn't fight. It wouldn't be an even match. So maybe they're just old buddies. Watch out, Nyala. You can see there, Nyala on the left there. Yes, girl, you better move out of the way. I think she knows these elephants. She said she wasn't hanging around at all, moving right off and into the bushes away from that big boy. Normally you see young elephants chasing other animals around. That's quite common. And I suppose when you're the size of the elephant on the right, and I think I actually changed my mind, I think it is him that was chasing that poor hippopotamus around. I think he's got a bit of a problem with his ego at the moment. So he thought that he could just sort of bully something that's smaller than him, seeing as though he's just been put in his place. So Mr. Elephant on the left, I take my comments back about you being a bully. I think it's the younger elephant that was perhaps behaving badly this afternoon. Must be a couple of flies on him though, as he swats his tail quite vigorously. And you probably were thinking, how does an elephant even feel a fly on that tough skin? But they're actually covered in bristles. Now, Matak, you're wondering if that younger elephant bull's tusk will ever regrow. I don't know if it's broken off, or maybe he just didn't grow a tusk. I didn't really see. Brian, did you see if he had a tusk? It didn't look like it.
No.
So maybe it's broken right off at the base that we just can't see. But no, I don't think it will. If he wasn't born with a tusk, then he'd probably never get another one. If it was snapped off, there's a possibility that it will continue to grow. However, it doesn't grow very much, and it takes quite a long time. So I couldn't see too much of it. But what I'd like to do now, though, is I'd like to go back down towards the dam. And actually, no, have a look at that sunset. I'm going to reposition just slightly. We're not going to go far. All I'm going to do is I'm just going to turn just a little bit because it's so beautiful, and then we'll go to the dam, I promise. That is incredible. Now, this is a different scene with all these beautiful trees as a silhouette. Isn't that lovely? Now, Druha, you're wondering, how long do elephants live for? They live for quite some time. They live for anywhere between 60 and 70 years. That is stunning. Those silver cluster leaves do a really good job when they're smaller, and they make beautiful sort of silhouette shots. Not too many leaves, but just the right amount. Now there's an impala creeping into the shot. Try and catch a couple of screenshots of that. That's really lovely. Oh, that's my favorite. And like I always say, there's not too many spots on Juma, I'm afraid, to get beautiful shots like this, where you can get the silhouette of an animal and the clear open sky. Isn't that beautiful? It seems as though these bulls have started pushing each other around again. I just heard one clash, or a clash of a tusk. Sorry, I'm trying to duck so that you can see them in front of me. And you may have heard it. Having an arm wrestle. Liz, you're quite correct in saying, well done for remembering the things that I'm saying as well. I sometimes forget what I say. So, Liz, you've commented and said, could the older bull be the mentor of this younger bull? And I have said this. You're quite right. I said this morning, actually. Now, I don't think so. Not just because the age difference is quite close and their size is quite close. Typically, you see it with much younger bulls. So you'll see the big bull that we saw on the left. And then you'll see bulls that have usually just been kicked out of the herd. So anywhere from about 16 to about 25 around there. And then normally after that, they're quite large and they start to separate from those bachelor groups and go off on their own. Though occasionally you'll see these super groups where you've got these monster elephants all moving together. But the way that the one on the right is behaving, you can see here, he's being very cheeky. And I think that this other elephant is going to get sick of him in a moment and then really just show him how powerful he is. But let's watch. Let's see what happens. Well, even though it doesn't look like there's much difference in size, you saw the length of the trunk, the thickness of the trunk, and just the overall size of their body. It's almost like they're having a standoff. Now we just have to wait and see who's going to make the next move. I don't know where to look, whether to look at the elephants or to look at the sunset with the impala. It's just so beautiful. Yeah, I think that's a fantastic call. Look at all these impala now coming through. Crossing the plain is another opportunity for some silhouettes. We're just going to have to keep bouncing between the sunset and, of course, those elephants who are having a great time. But look at them. Here comes another impala. Put your heads up so we can get some photos. There's even the southern ground hornbills calling in the background. Now this has been absolutely incredible. I just want to very quickly show you, look how they're pushing each other now. All that dust coming off the older bull on the left. Let's see if they give one more push and shove. Isn't that amazing? Come on, boys, give us one last show. See how that one is resting his trunk on the younger bulls. Now that must be heavy. Remember, that's all muscle. There we go. And you can see this is nothing serious. This is really just them sort of testing each other's strength. Wasn't that incredible? Right, that was beautiful, but I believe that James has also got a roadblock of his own.
Right, everybody, we found a bit of an obstacle in the ground here, and much as those elephants were pushing each other, so they have pushed the sea over. And what I thought I would do is see if we could discover one or two things under the bark. I have discovered something that I'm going to come and show you now, but the first thing I need to do, of course, is move it out of the road. I think I'm feeling a bit weak today, David. I'll bring you this thing that I was going to show you, but first I'm going to attempt some more cross-country. There we go, do you see that? That was very lithe, wasn't it? Yes, very nice. Now, of course, under the bark of that tree, which probably died some time ago, it's a knobthorn tree, you find many things. I was hoping to find a bark scorpion, but there wasn't one there. This seems to be some kind of an egg sac. I suspect from a spider, and of course the spiders that we live under this bark, quite often the violin spiders, everybody, and they of course are deeply, deeply venomous. So I'm going to put it back and then we'll carry on. I will tell you that we went to Biffleshook Dam. There is one lonely hippopotamus there, but he wasn't being as entertaining as the elephants you were looking at, so we didn't tarry for long, and that was about it over there. We're now going to drive Drakensberg Road towards the south in the hopes that maybe Karula's come back across. We might be lucky, we might not. We'll find something else on the way. Marvellous to have had so many sunset shots. Let me plug myself in so that I can hear you speak to me. There we are. And on we go. Yes, I definitely, Deborah Armchair Traveller, I agree with you completely. You say I should get Jamie to help me next time. Jamie, of course, very powerful. We've seen her move logs probably four or five times that size out of the road. So yes, I shall have to find out exactly what her workout is and do the same. I'll be able to do that on Wednesday next week. Now, let's see what else we have here. I've been astounded by the number of buffalo, and I'm taking back what I said earlier about them not moving around too much like the other animals have for the rain. That's absolute nonsense. It's one of the reasons they've been killed so much over here, is that they have come into this area, and there are so many of them around that the Nkuhumas just can't help themselves. Every bush they look behind, there's a starving, emaciated buffalo that they then kill. Watch out here, David. There's some branches. Phew. Ah. Thank you. Some of you seem to find my tree moving segment quite amusing. I'm sorry I wasn't quite able to do it. Now, the main reason I actually stopped at that tree was the last time I stopped at a tree, of course, I failed to jump over it. I became scared and sort of vaulted over it. And this time I thought, well, this one's a bit smaller. I should be able to get over this one, which I did. Made me feel young and youthful, David. I suppose we better put the lights on. The sun is gone. There we are. The last call. Let's just have a listen to that again. Listen. Please call again, bird. No, the white-browed scrub robin makes that last call at this time of the day. Like the snare drummer in the band at the changing of the guard. And of course, course, it is the changing of the guard now, this time of the day. And the creatures of the night come out, and the creatures of the day go into whatever hidey holes they can find. Much the same as we do. As our human ancestors would have now lit the fire. I was reading an interesting article the other day that was sent to me about lions and their activity levels and when they're active and when they aren't. And I mean, it wasn't particularly profound, but one of the interesting things it did say was that it reckons that we as human beings are probably nervous of the dark because of the fact that lions are active precisely when we are not. They're active at night, they're much more confident at night, and if you look at records of lion attacks on people around Africa, they almost always happen just after sunrise, so around about now, up until sort of 10 or 11 at night. And that's why now is the kind of time we'd start lighting fires, gathering everybody together, which I thought was quite interesting. It seems very intuitively obvious when you think about it, but if you do think deeply into it, you think, well, why would we be afraid of the dark? And that's why. So while we're the apex predator during the day, at night time, not so much. Now we're going to just... There's a little water hole up ahead, and I'm rather hoping that by this stage of the game, we should have one or two foam nest frogs. They've been calling around the place. They go, wuck, wuck. And there's a giraffe who thinks I make a very good foam nest call, frog call. There he is, wuck. Well, so I've stopped you in a perfect position, haven't I, David? Yeah, don't worry, there's another one up ahead. Let's go there, rather. Two young bulls, much like those two elephants you were watching with Taylor, making their way in the world, keeping each other company before they're fully mature enough to sort of go off on their own and fight for mating opportunities. I think the giraffe have maintained health very well as well. They've got through the winter time fine, and because their food doesn't respond to water necessarily, it responds to day length, they've got lots of greenery to eat at the moment. Giraffe are also, of course, pretty much water independent, which means they'll drink if they have to, but they don't have to. And so they would have weathered the dry times probably a lot more easily than many of the other animals out here. Marvellous. Let us carry on around the way and see if we can't find our little foam nest frog. Wuck. Wuck. David, would you like to try the foam nest frog call? Try it. That's very good, David. Very excellent job. Well done. Wuck. That is a slightly ridiculous. Okay, good. We're nearly at the water. Wuck. I challenge you, everybody, not to go through the rest of your day or night not thinking to yourself, wuck. James, you say you'd love to see a frog tonight. Well, let's just look here. Oh, quickly. There are no frogs here. Let's quickly head across to Taylor. She's got something very endangered.
How fast it was flying. Now, Liz, you were asking earlier about sort of the young elephant bulls that I sort of mentioned that sort of tail the older bulls. Now, we found three of them. This is one of them in front of us, and he's a young chap, not too far from the two older boys, probably just a couple of meters. I can still hear those others fighting in the far distance. But they were going into some thick bush, but there's the other two. Now, these are typical elephant bulls that will be following the large Eli, learning how to be, as Brian says, learning how to be big elephants. And they're young. They're probably a variety of different ages. They actually look like they're younger than 20 years old. They seem to be quite young. Probably only just recently pushed out of the breeding herds. I can hear lions. Don't know if you could hear that. It sounds in the distance. I can hear a male lion roaring, though. I think we need to go and investigate. What do you think, Brian? I think we do. Elephants, it's getting a bit dark to film you now, so we're going to leave you. Leave these elephants in peace. But I didn't see any Birmingham boys, or not that I could really see too many lions when we were on Arethusa. Bye, chaps. Have a good evening. Stay out of trouble. But let's go and look. We're going to go and head along Mvubu Road towards Biffles or Cutline. It sounded like it was perhaps coming through from that side. So let's go around there. I could also be mistaken slightly because I am sitting in a little bit of a dip. So that sound could be sort of just distorted, but we'll go and have a look. And if he's roaring like that, perhaps he's on the move, which is always quite tricky. But we will give it a bash. Whee! Down we go. We're going over the dam wall. We'll just have a little look around here. We'll have a quick look at our friend the hippopotamus, who was being chased around earlier this afternoon. But just a very quick look. You can see he's much happier now that he's not being bothered too much by, of course, the elephants. Happy days, hippopotamus. Enjoy your food. Bon appetit. Right, let's continue going. Just a quick look of him. You never know what we're going to come across when the sun goes down. Sorry, I keep forgetting that when I'm driving on the dam wall, I really need to focus on the wall, on the road, and not look around too much. Otherwise, that could potentially be quite disastrous. Let's go on an adventure. Ah, we've had some suspicion. Oh no, I'm trying to do too many things at once. My spotlight was caught on a wire and I couldn't really pull it properly. Now, Shark, you said that you think it could possibly be Tinyo. It definitely could. I don't think he was around, so we'll keep an eye on it. So let's play a guessing game. If we are lucky enough and we find this line, let's see, who do you think it's going to be? Do you think it's going to be Tinyo, or do you think it's going to be Mfumo? And we'll see who's right. Well, we'll only be able to tell you if we find the line making the noise, of course. What do you think, Brian?
Tinyo.
Tinyo? I think I'm also going to go with Tinyo. Just because we heard him vocalizing quite a bit the other morning. We know what he's like, so let's go and look and see. So you can send in your answers as who you think it may be that we're going to, or that we heard roaring in the far distance, either by hashtagging Safari Live on Twitter, or you can send us an email, questions@wildearth.tv. Either one of those will be good. Doesn't smell. Sorry. You know what I'm smelling? It's the carcass from about a week ago. Just in over there. Buffalo. Can you see it? Here it is. That cow that they killed. So we're on Mvubu Road. So we're right near the lodge. Very delicious indeed, Louise. It doesn't seem as though there's too much feeding on it. Been a good couple of scraps though for a jackal. Right, just a little bit bumpy here. We're going to carry on. Now I'm going to focus on the road as much as I can. I'm also going to try and look for things like chameleons, but it's going to be quite difficult because I'm going to be sort of looking on other parts. I'm not going to be looking as high up. I'm going to be scanning the brush. Oh my goodness, this road just gets bumpier and bumpier every time I drive it. Sorry, Brian, if I almost throw you off. And I hope we're going to find this line. That'll be so exciting and make my day if we do. Just because we didn't have the normal fantastic sighting of the Nkuhumas like we've been so spoiled with. Put all the lights on. No, I'm just a couple of diurnal animals, lots of zebra and impala around here, so I don't want to shine on them. I'm just going to put my spotlight down until we pass these herds. Hello, guys. Be safe out there tonight. There we go. Now we've passed them. Right, now we're going to continue searching far and wide for this mysterious male lion. And while we do this, let's go for an update with James.
Nothing to report this side at this stage, everybody. We're looking for chameleons, of course, in every bushel, and we're now around Ledwood Road, where we'd hoped Karula went sometime yesterday. Byron was under some confusion today about whether or not she'd come north or south. He found tracks coming north, which is good. That's where we are. We are north of the road, of the boundary. And then, unfortunately, somebody else seemed to think that they'd gone south. So it's well worth our while just having a little drive down Ledwood Road, which is named, of course, for the Ledwood tree at the other end of it. I'll show it to you. I have shown it to you. Ooh. Darby? Oh, shame. It's that juvenile battalier that we've been seeing around here quite often. I'm going to move out of the area simply because I think that bird's going to struggle to land if it gets any darker than this. So I just want to move so that if it wants to come back there, it can. It's always been interesting to me since I think I've told many of you the story before, but I had a girlfriend once. Yes, I did have a girlfriend once, and she was she was quite a vicious creature, and she had a cockatiel. And the cockatiel's name was Newman. That's right, after Kenneth Newman, who wrote many of the bird books. And when she and I parted ways, I was left after the divorce with the bird for a little while. I had single custody of it for a while. And the bird and I lived at Dingala Private Game Reserve. And Newman the bird used to, I didn't like keeping him in a cage, so I used to just let him out in the room and he'd live in the room, which apart from, you know, producing a situation where there was little bird droppings all over the room, it made me feel a bit better that he was living a life of relative comfort. Anyway, Newman used to at night, so he'd sleep on top of his cage, which I'd hung from the roof, and he'd have his food and his water inside there, and he'd go. There's another big bird there, Darby. It's in the... Yeah, that's it. I'm reticent to put too much light on it, but let's just see what it is, because that's very low down. No, no, left, right, there. Up, up, up. Right. There's a hornbill calling. Dave, can you see it there? This big tree here, straight up the main trunk there. There you got it. Ah, it's a gymnogene, everyone. And can you hear the hornbill calling next to us? It's not a gymnogene, is it? Yes, it is. It's a gymnogene. And next to us, the harrier, not the harrier, that is the harrier hawk. Next to us, the ground hornbill going, hooroo, hoorooroo, hooroo, hoorooroo. Isn't that lovely? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And the hornbills was such a mournful but beautiful call. He's on his own. Can't hear a response from any others. There's also black-bellied bustard calling him. Beautiful call. Anyway, Newman, the bird, used to sleep on his cage. And sometimes at night, he'd get a fright, probably from the bat that used to come in every so often, and then he'd fly around. And he'd fly around and around and around, and he wouldn't land. And I couldn't figure it out until one night and then he'd fly into things. He'd land on my face, and then he'd sometimes just sleep on the bed next to me. But when I turned the light on one night, he immediately went straight back to his perch and landed. And it reminded me, there's the hornbill. It's just going to be a silhouette, everyone, because I don't want to put a light on it. It's quite nice as a silhouette, isn't it, Dave? Oh, it's so sad. They're, of course, flocks, so they live with other birds. Normally this calling goes on very early in the morning. And if you listen very carefully, you can hear the beak snapping shut as he makes the call. It's just a slight click. Poor fellow, he's obviously looking for friends. Okay, let's leave him be. Anyway, finally, I realized that, of course, a bird which sees in color cannot land at night because it can't see anything at night. Just like us, because they see in color, unlike most mammals, they really have very poor night vision if they are diurnal birds. And that is the end of the story of Newman, who was eventually taken by his mother, and history doesn't relate what happened to him after that. I assume by this stage of the game, that was about, what was that, about 15 years ago, believe it or not. Good grief, that's a long time. I assume he's probably shaken off this mortal coil. R.I.P. Newman the cockatiel. Luca, you're wondering about owls. Just before I answer your question, I saw some eyes in here. I didn't know what they belonged to, but I think it was probably a duiker. Anyway, can't see it anymore. Luca, you said, do we get any milky owls or only African eagle owls? Luca, we get about 7 species of owl here. None of them are the milky owl, though. We get, and if I was, it was daytime, I'd show you in the book. We get the spotted eagle owl, the giant eagle owl, the grass owl, the Scops owl, the pearl-spotted owl, the barred owl, the barn owl. That's 7 already, isn't it? And I think we get one other. What is it? I've missed one. I think the marsh owl you'll find in the south of the Sabi Sand. So those are the owls that we get here. Quite a few of them. And the white-faced Scops owl, of course. So that's another one. So 9, actually. 9 species of owl in this particular region. Then you get one other as well called the Pell's fishing owl down on the Sand River sometimes. So 9 species, but I'm afraid none of them the milky owl. I've never heard of the milky owl. I'm assuming it's probably not an African species. We'll try and find you some owls. This is around about the time of the year that we'd be expecting to see them. And as we talk about the owls and their activities and the activities of nocturnal birds, Ray, you say, do they come out in the day or in the night? Normally at night, Ray. The pearl-spotted owl has been known to be fairly crepuscular, so it moves around sort of at dawn and dusk. But the eagle owl is generally at night time, and that's when you'll see them. White-faced scops owl the same, barn owl the same, grass owls also. So they're largely nocturnal, scops owls also. And you know that, of course, even if you don't see them at night, you know that because that's when they call. They don't call during the day at all. Sometimes in the early morning you'll hear them, and sometimes you will hear a pearl-spotted owl calling in the morning and in the middle of the day. Now here is the Leadwood, after which Leadwood Road gets its name. There it is. Is it not magnificent, David? It is. It is dead, of course, unfortunately. Shaken off this mortal coil. Ah, there it is. We'll have a quick paint up it. There we are. And then we'll head across to Taylor and find out how her night, this the 4th of November, is going.
So we've just been driving around. We had another listen and we stopped on Bivilsook Road and we heard that male lion roar again. It sounded quite far, actually much further away than I initially anticipated. But I reckon by tomorrow morning, hopefully, he will be across. But I don't think we'll get him tonight. But we'll keep listening out. But now we're looking for all the weird and wonderful creatures that come out after the sun disappears. So, of course, you know, I don't even need to tell you anymore. Chameleons. That's actually what I'm really looking for tonight, is a chameleon. And seeing as though James was talking about owls, I also wouldn't mind seeing an owl like I did the other night. And I thought, in the very far distance, I thought I could hear a barn owl. Now, that's an interesting bird. I actually want to stop. I want to play its call for you. You just turn the spotlight off. Now, I've only saw when I was down in the south three, and they're quite special to see, so I don't even know if you know what a barn owl looks like. Let me show you first. I'm just getting to the picture, so here we go. See that? Beautiful. Unmistakable face. See those dark black eyes, and of course with a very round head and the round face. It's very, very easy to identify. So I saw three, which is quite rare. They're not as common up here. You see a lot of spotted eagle owls, a lot of Arose owls, and of course the little owlets that we occasionally see too. But let me play the call for you. It's quite an interesting sound, and I heard it in the very far distance. I have to put it next to my mic. Very scary. That would have been a good call to play on Halloween, don't you think? That would scare a couple of neighbors, I think, if they were coming around to trick or treat. And we'll put the phone back on silent again after the bird calls. Now, that would be a very special one to see around here. Where I'm from, though, the Eastern Cape of South Africa, actually quite common. Them and the spotted eagle owls we used to see most. And then we're very lucky to also see the barred owlet, which is exceptionally rare down there. And I was very lucky, myself and two other people, we went walking one day and we could hear these barred owlets calling, and we'd only seen one. And they hadn't been recorded in the area for about 25 years or so. So we went out and we made a mission. We went during the day and we said, right, we're going to go and find these owls. And we did. We were so lucky. We didn't find one, though. We found two. We found a breeding pair. That was quite nice. That was recorded with BirdLife South Africa as one of the first breeding pairs. Oh, wow. After 25 years. Now, I've got a scorpion. Let me just get a good position. Hello, scorpion. Now this looks like one of the burrowing scorpions. You can see the very large pincers. And I did say to you that the burrowing scorpions are starting to come out now. And they're quite aggressive. Now if I were to go up to that scorpion, I'm not going to agitate it. It would almost rattle and hiss at me and obviously stick its tail up and try and sting me. I don't know why they've got such a complex about themselves, because the most venomous of scorpions are actually very relaxed. You can quite easily pick them up and handle them. Oh, where are you? There you are. But he's out and about now looking for something to eat. Possibly some millipedes. Let's see what he does. You're going to see lots and lots of them around. We're seeing them at camp. So you've gone from everybody wearing open sandals to now wearing closed shoes, because you wouldn't want to be zapped by one of those. Not because you'd have to go to hospital, just because it would be really, really painful. You just stop for a moment. What have you spotted? Well, that's something I'd really like to see, is I'd like to see a scorpion taking on a millipede or some form of prey. I think that'd be quite amazing. I've never been lucky enough to see anything along those lines, a scorpion kill. This is quite big as well. It's probably almost about the length of my hand, maybe just shy of the length of my hand. So say if you just took halfway of your palm and then went right up to the top of your index finger, that's how long it is. So it's not a small one. Not like the olive bark scorpions that we see, or even the Osteopacanthus asper, is slightly smaller than this. Going through, here you go, something caught its interest. I was trying to, you see, it looked like it wanted to dig for a second. Sort of just surveying the area at the moment. And they'll be feeling four vibrations on the little hairs that they have on their bodies. Now looking at its tail, it doesn't have a thin tail. It's got quite a thick tail sort of to its body ratio. Now David from Napa, you're wondering if that sting could penetrate a shoe. Luckily, no, it can't. If you're wearing a sandal though and you've got any exposed skin, well then you're going to be in trouble. And if you're barefoot, oh, there, got a bit defensive. Something gave it a fright. Yeah, quickly that scorpion could move as well. So no, you'd be all right if you were wearing shoes. But if you were to put your foot in your shoe while there was a scorpion in there, well, then that'd probably sting you. So always be careful and always bang your shoes. Look at it, it's going into a hole of some sort. Is that another scorpion? Yeah. We've got two. Oh, scorpion fight. That was interesting. It's obviously, this other scorpion has come out of its burrow. Oh, this is exciting. Let's see what's going to happen. They're being quite aggressive towards each other. Oh no, it's retreating. I've never seen this before. This is very interesting. Oh no, I think we need to reposition. What do you think, Brian? Let's quickly get around before we miss any more action. I'm just going to just change our position slightly. Seems as though they've gone into a burrow there. How exciting was that? And that's what happens when you just sit and watch something like this. You never know what's going to happen. Maybe they've gone though. Can you get that? Is that too close? No, is that fine? They're in here somewhere. Now we just have to wait and see. I don't know exactly which burrow they went into, but you can see there's a sort of a series of holes going there and then going further up towards the tree. You can see there's a nice big hole. And that would be a fantastic spot for a scorpion to live. There they are. Oh, they go back down to that hole. There we go. There's one of the pincers. Sorry, this spotlight is very hot. There's a whole sort of burrow system under there. I don't think that they would have necessarily created that. I think there's a bit of erosion that's gone on after this tree has been pushed over by the elephants. And the roots have sort of lifted the ground slightly and made all these wonderful cavities for these various insects to live in. Sorry, I just need to rest my arm on. There we go, that's better. keep it a little bit steadier. I wonder what's going to happen now. This is very interesting, of course. Now, Cats in Tampa is wondering if a spider-hunting wasp would go after a scorpion. I don't think so. I've never seen it before. I've seen quite a number of times the spider-hunting wasp actually pulling spiders out of their burrows, from baboon spiders to rain spiders. But I've never seen them going after anything else. So, just my opinion, I don't think so. That would be very scary, though. Oh, Scorpion, are you going to come out? I'm being plagued by bugs. So I just want to turn off the big lights just so that all the bugs settle down a little bit. And I wonder if it isn't sitting here waiting to ambush something. It's a good strategy. And I think these scorpions do ambush. They'll sort of rush out of their hole, either sting their prey, which will have a mild venom that would be able to paralyze whatever they're potentially eating, or it'll grab it with those great big pincers. So they can chase their prey too, or like we're seeing now, this is what I think is going on, is I think that this scorpion has been out surveying and not having too much luck, so it's going for a different technique now. Now, Jen Marvey, you've commented and said that possibly these scorpions are mating. I'm not sure, because we found this other scorpion quite far away from here, and I think that there'd be a size difference. And now those two looked sort of equal size, and it was very aggressive, their meeting. I haven't ever seen scorpions mating before, so I suppose I can't comment too much on it. But I reckon that just looked a little bit too aggressive, and the one scorpion didn't even know that the other was around and sort of surprise attacked it and then retreated. And then I think it sort of bit off a little bit more than it could chew and then ran away. But maybe, there's always a possibility. Like we said, we saw that interesting behavior between the crested Franklins. Now, Jean, you've caught me off guard. You want to know if there is a difference, how to tell the difference between a male and a female scorpion. I actually don't have any idea, I'm afraid. I'd have to look that up, sorry. I'm a little bit uncertain. Maybe you can help me. Maybe you can have a look and see. I could imagine that there would be a size difference, though. We normally see that with insects, that quite often the female is larger than the male because she's got to sort of keep all those eggs. So possibly, like I said, those two looked very much of equal size. Isn't that wonderful? Okay, well, I think that's the end of the scorpions, I'm afraid. I don't know where they've gone, and unfortunately we don't have sort of a CT scan or anything like radiation to view down into that burrow. Whew, the spotlight is hot. So let's carry on and see what else we can find out here. It's wonderful this evening. It's all happening, and I've got all sorts of bugs crawling on my legs now. Seeing as though we're having that much luck, maybe we will see something like a chameleon. We can only hope. And while we were sitting there, I was also listening out to see if we could perhaps hear the lions, but I didn't hear them again. They've gone very quiet. Oh, it's very hot all of a sudden, very humid. Thank you, Raisa. You've just given me some wonderful information. You said that apparently next week, Monday, there's supposed to be a super moon when the moon rises. That's going to be exciting, and we'll definitely keep an eye out for that. Perhaps we'll see something like that. I'm not sure what time it's going to rise, but it's getting dark. So let's keep our fingers crossed that we'll be out to see something like that. And well, and let's hope for no clouds as well. Clear sky. That would be very, very special. Imagine just sitting on quarantine and waiting for it to come out. That would be nice. So diarize that, remember that, and please remind us, especially me, because I forget things all the time. I sometimes forget my own name. Now, we're going down one of my favorite roads, which is Gallego Shortcut. And we're going to have just a quick look here. I'm convinced that one day I'm going to see a chameleon or something interesting down here. I just love this road at night. But unfortunately, I'm going to have to say goodbye to you, and we're going to have to save this for another time. So it's been wonderful, as always. I hope you've enjoyed it. So have a lovely evening from myself and Brian and, of course, Thumb lurking in the bottom left of your screen, and we'll catch you for the sunrise drive. But let's go across to James, who is still out and about searching for things.
Well, of course I'm out and about. We're not finished the drive yet, are we, David? No, we're not. Since I last saw you, everybody, which was some time ago, you can see I'm very sore after shining the spotlight. We had some information from, I think, our beard. Was it our beard, Luisi? Never mind. That I'd cast aspersions on the Milky Owl thing. And the Milky Owl thing is, in fact, completely true. I checked it up in the book, at least in the app. And yes, the Verroes Eagle Owl, the giant eagle owl, is known also as the Milky Eagle Owl. So thank you very much for teaching me that. That's wonderful stuff. And that, of course, is the joy of being the biggest safari vehicle in the world, is that you never know more than everyone. And certainly not more than Google. So thank you very much for that. Wonderful to have learned. We're just easing towards Quarantine clearings, and we'll see what else we can see in the last minute or two. But given that all of the impalas are up here, I think you will find that there is not a great deal in the way of large predatory cats. I was rather hoping for Tingana the male leopard. All the impala are coming running towards us because they are stunned by the light. Try and get in. They don't want to move. Sorry, everybody, I know you can't see anything now, nor can I. They're completely and utterly stupid. There we go. Go on. Jeepers, I nearly drove into that rather large apple leaf tree. Marula tree, sorry, David. I know that I saw you shaking your head there saying to yourself, I don't think that's an apple leaf tree at all. And it wasn't. Impala. Absolutely everywhere you look. I'm just going to scan briefly from side to side to see if I can't spot a baby. Everyone, they've got to be more than 500 impala on quarantine clearings right now. Every time I turn the light from side to side, I see another little pocket of 20 or 30. They're a waterbuck, and I know we can't shine on them. But I'm just quickly scanning. A waterbuck, there's a zebra. We'll just quietly go through here. It's amazing. All of them using each other's eyes, ears, and noses to hear or smell or see the predators coming across. Hello, talisker buck. Sorry about that. I didn't mean to hit that log that gave you a big fright. There we are. I think we're clear of them now. And that hot wind from the northwest continues to blow, which is, well, it's kind of cooking me. I feel like I've been in an oven for most of the afternoon, even though it wasn't that hot today. That is the house of the landowner, Yuri Mulman, and his wife, Pippa. That is where they holiday from their Honin Hutspruit. Now we're nearly home.
And so it comes once again to the time of the night when we must bid you a fond and very fantastic farewell. Thank you, David. Well done. Good. So big thank you to David for his efforts today. Thank you, David. And thank you to Taylor and Brian on the other vehicle. I'm not sure what the thumb was, but I'm sure it was spectacular. To Pavid and Max Smith in the final control also, and to all of you,